Breaking overnight, Australia's 64th coronavirus patient. A man admitted to a Brisbane hospital after returning from overseas. 100,000 cases now worldwide as cruise ship passengers, including Australians, are left stranded, anxiously waiting for test results.
Happening now, virus rationing. Supermarkets take drastic steps after panic buying strips shelves bare. This morning, the expert explanation for the hysterical scenes.
New this morning, royal tour in doubt. Prince William and Kate's international travel under review as Qantas joins other airlines in cutting overseas routes to stop the virus spreading.
Also this morning, health alert, the truth about diet drinks. Scientific research revealing how they could be changing your metabolism to actually put on weight.
Plus, competition bonanza, the unprecedented number of holidays up for grabs, tipping the odds more in your favour.
Don't miss DIY weddings, the 2020 trends that are changing the day, the bridal wear, and culling that ever-expanding guest list.
Plus, the woman who stopped Celine Dion in her tracks.
I hold you in my arms and never let go. I surrender.
See what Celine did next on Weekend Sunrise this Saturday, the 7th of March, 2020.
Right across Australia, this is Weekend Sunrise. Now live from Brekkie Central, Monique and Matt.
Good morning and welcome to Weekend Sunrise. It's so lovely to have your company this morning. Also coming up, have you seen this? Kookaburra cull. You know, we love kookaburras, right? But there is a state in Australia where our lovable laughing birds are considered to be a pest. Now, action is being considered to stop them nesting in the old gum trees. They're going to cull them.
Very controversial indeed. And honouring a legend, a special night for Channel 7's Bruce McAvaney as his lifetime of contribution to Australian sport is recognised.
Yes, and we're going to be going right through all of his hair. Stars. Oh, how well deserved is that? That is coming up this morning. But we begin with the coronavirus reaching a dramatic new level with more than 100,000 cases now confirmed worldwide.
Serbia has just recorded its first case, meaning 90 countries are now infected globally.
Kensington Palace is reportedly reviewing William and Kate's international travel over virus fears putting their Australia tour in doubt.
64 people here now have the potentially deadly virus after a 28-year-old Brisbane man was admitted to hospital following a trip to Iran.
Now, it comes a day after the first Australian school was shut down as fears grow of a cluster outbreak in Sydney's northwest. There's no word on when Epping Boys High School will reopen after a Year 11 student was confirmed to have the virus.
Student from the Epping School, they rode around this street and are living in this street.
This morning, it's reported the New South Wales Education Department is urgently moving to digitise learning. That would enable students to attend virtual classes from home in the event of a mass shutdown of the public school system. And right now, there is an anxious wait among cruise ship passengers who'll learn soon whether they have tested positive to the COVID-19 virus.
Let's go live now to 7 News US correspondent Amelia Brace, who is in San Francisco for us. Amelia, good morning to you. So do we know when these passengers will find out?
Well, Mon, I've spoken to some passengers on board this morning who say that the captain's told them he will make an announcement in about an hour's time, though at this stage it's not clear whether that will be these test results. It's estimated that dozens of people have fallen ill on this ship, and the reason that there's concern they could be carrying coronavirus is that 3 people from the first leg of this ship's voyage actually tested positive for the virus, one of which went on to die. 62 people from that first leg continued onto this second leg. So now as a result, everyone is in quarantine and being told to stay in their rooms, as one passenger explained to me.
They're not having any contact with us. They will not come in our rooms and make up the rooms or turn down the beds. They're strictly just handing from door to door.
And guys, also this morning, the captain has put a call out for anyone who needs prescriptions beyond tomorrow to fill out a form so that those drugs can be airdropped out to the ship. That is obviously not a good sign in terms of how long they anticipate being out there.
Yeah, very much an anxious wait for all of those passengers. Thanks very much to Amelia Brace there for us in San Francisco. Coronavirus very much top of mind for so many Australians.
Yeah, imagine how hideous that would be to be on that ship, especially knowing what happened with the Diamond Princess.
Well, at least they're going to get an update this morning. Hopefully that's good news. Here's Sally, though, with the rest of today's news.
Good morning. Global share markets have taken another blow with the coronavirus crisis shaking investor confidence. The Dow Jones opened sharply lower, down more than 800 points a short time ago in London. The FTSE 100 is also falling, down 3.6%. Australian markets closed lower yesterday with fears of a major economical flow-on effect. Qantas, meanwhile, has joined other airlines, reducing some flights in response to decreasing demand amid the outbreak. Flights from Japan, Hong Kong and Auckland will be scaled back. Tasmania is considering culling one of Australia's most iconic birds due to overpopulation. Kookaburra numbers have blown out across the island state in recent years. The species is considered a pest by many locals, with the birds killing and displacing smaller native birds, including endangered species. The state's main wildlife rescue director has told News Corp it needs to happen in a humane way. The Duke and Duchess of Sussex have geared up with a six-time Formula One driver, Lewis Hamilton, to open a new museum at an English racetrack. 7 News Europe correspondent Sarah Greenalch joins us live from London this morning. Good morning to you, Sarah. He certainly arrived in style.
Good morning, Sally. Harry certainly did. He arrived chauffeured by Lewis Hamilton himself in an electric Mercedes to open up the Silverstone Experience, which is a new immersive museum dedicated to British motor racing. Harry is a bit of a racing fan. He first went to the British Grand Prix with his mum, Princess Diana, back in 1994. So perhaps somewhat fitting that this could have been the last thing that Harry opens up as a senior member, or senior working member rather, of the royal family before he and Meghan step down at the end of the month. This is being called their farewell tour. They have a couple more events over the weekend and then the big finale on Monday, the Commonwealth Day service at Westminster Abbey. The whole family will be attending and the whole world will be watching. Today on the couple's Instagram account, they actually released some photos showing that yesterday Meghan made a secret solo visit to London's National Theatre where she is a patron.
All right. Thank you very much. Sarah Greenalch reporting there from London for us this morning. Well, they are certainly busy in this farewell, final wrap-up of their royal life, Harry.
I know, they look incredibly happy.
That photo of them in the rain yesterday.
It's so gorgeous.
Rock star. It was, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was concerned, though, about all the hands-on on those in that interactive museum.
It wouldn't be Simon Reeve if you weren't concerned about something.
I would like to see them both just with hand sanitizer. It doesn't quite go with the whole rock star, amazing, glittery, gorgeous.
It takes a bit of the sheen off it, doesn't it?
Does. Plenty more to come, including a Sam Kerr double as the Matildas move one step closer to a spot in the Tokyo Olympics.
Australia's number one holiday hotspot revealed. You'll never guess the place that has stolen the crown.
And JT has swapped the board shorts for ski gear this morning. He'll have your Saturday weather forecast live from Mammoth Mountain in California with a something.
What is that?
Welcome back to Weekend Sunrise on this very happy Saturday morning. It's time for sport news now with Simon to just make it happier.
It's not that happy.
Bring the mood down.
Thanks, Mon. The Matildas have one foot on the plane for Tokyo 2020 after thumping Vietnam 5-0 in their Olympic qualifier last night. Superstar Sam Kerr was all smiles as the Matildas captain scored twice to become the team's second highest ever goal scorer.
At speed, and Sam Kerr on the end of things. Australia with a goal. 10 minutes in on the road to Tokyo 2020.
Great crowd in Newcastle. The Aussies made light work of the world's number 32 ranked team, all but assuring a place at the Olympics. The return leg is in Vietnam on Wednesday. Gold Coast, Hawthorn and Melbourne will be sweating on the fitness of key players on the eve of the AFL season. The Suns' Alex Sexton limped off the field in their pre-season win against Adelaide with a suspected hammy. Young hawk Mitchell Lewis was carried off with an ankle injury. That looked bad. While Demon, sorry Matty, Sam Wiedemann also hurt his ankle in their win. The AFLW, Geelong has kept its finals hopes alive. A 20-point win over the Sunnies.
Bouncing through now. Is that score? That is a goal to Rocky right on the siren.
The Cats sit fourth in Conference A in the AFLW. Meanwhile, Scott McDonald broke his scoring drought for the Brisbane Roar in their 3-1 win over the Wanderers in the A-League last night. The former Celtic frontman hadn't scored for Brisbane since moving from Western United in January, but he was in sparkling form, scoring twice in the first half.
Cross deflected, tap in, Scott McDonald at the double.
Western Sydney captain Mitch Duke kept his five-game scoring streak going. It wasn't enough, though, to prevent defeat for the Wanderers. We are very jealous of JT today.
Thank you.
Very jealous.
Okay. A very special part of the world.
JT, everyone is jealous. You're at Mammoth Mountain in California, except for those of us that can't ski. We're not as jealous. It looks amazing, though, and you've got a mascot with you. What more could you want on the top of a mountain?
I love how negative you get on the snow. Wooly is such a superstar. And not just kids, adults are obsessed with him. People are coming up wanting photos. Let me just ask these people a question. Whereabouts are you guys from?
I'm from Mexico.
Do you know about Wooly?
No.
Oh, you just saw a mascot and you wanted a photo?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So we are in California, Mammoth Mountain. We're actually doing four resorts over 4 days this weekend. So we're going to be in California this weekend, a totally different resort tomorrow. Then next weekend, we're in two resorts over in Colorado. And the reason we're doing that is because you can buy a pass that covers not just all of those fields, but there are fields and resorts in America, in Japan, in Australia, in New Zealand. So you can buy a pass that gets you unlimited access to Thredbo and Mount Buller in Australia. And then you can come to America, and then you can go to Japan, and then you go to Europe, and all of your lift tickets are covered. It's called the Icon Pass. So that's why we're on this road trip for two weekends, skiing and snowboarding. It is going to be fun. Summer's over in Australia. Let's think about the slopes. Let's have a look at your forecast.
This is Weekend Sunrise Weather.
There's a slow-moving trough generating rain and storms in eastern Queensland and northeastern New South Wales, with the trough and cold front bringing a few showers in southeastern New South Wales. Another trough is causing a few showers and storms in southern WA and in the northern tropics. The capitals, Brisbane, showers in 29, showers in Sydney in 24, Canberra, possible showers in 22, Melbourne, partly cloudy in 21, light showers in Hobart, 16 degrees, Adelaide, mostly sunny in 25, humid in Perth, 27 degrees, sunny in Broome and 35, Darwin, possible storms in 33, and sunny in Alice Springs and 30 degrees. Doesn't it look like a green screen? This is the top of Mammoth Mountain. Those mountains, this is the Sierra Mountains, and they are just spectacular. Ah, hello guys, big wave!
Calabasas.
Yeah, from Calabasas team to Australia. We'll see you back here in half an hour.
That looks amazing, JT. Thank you so much. Talk to you soon. Ahead on Weekend Sunrise, stand up for Ben Elton, the one and only, the man behind comedy classics like The Young Ones, Blackadder. He's in Australia with his stand-up tour. The new rules on what comedians can and can't say.
Plus, when panic attacks, the psychological explanation for the buying frenzy we're seeing at supermarkets, leading to toilet paper flying off the shelves.
And it's Biden versus Sanders. So who's likely to win the Democratic primaries, and can they beat the Don? That's coming up on Weekend Sunrise.
Welcome back. Well, they had racial, gender and sexual diversity, but after months of debates, Super Tuesday has narrowed the Democrats' field for US president from 28 candidates to two frontrunners, with Joe Biden and Bernie Sanders to slug it out.
One-time frontrunner Elizabeth Warren withdrew after Super Tuesday's election count, effectively leaving the Democratic Party with a choice between two men in their late 70s. But age is all they have in common. Former Vice President Biden is a moderate, Senator Sanders is a progressive. And this morning, Joe Biden has won 627 delegates. Bernie Sanders has 551, but the winner needs 1,991 delegates to win the nomination.
Sunrise foreign editor Dr. Keith Suter is here to discuss. Morning. Keith, good morning. What a difference a few weeks makes when you're talking politics,
Absolutely.
Of course. He looked very much down and out. It's been quite the comeback by Joe Biden.
Absolutely. It's remarkable recovery. You're looking now at the three dimensions of US politics: money, movement and momentum. So clearly the money is now beginning to flow into Biden, and also that he's developing much more of a movement, including people who are formerly contestants against him now coming in behind him. And also, of course, you've got the movement. So this sort of forward movement and momentum. So, you know, it looks as though he could end up as a candidate. Although I'm interested that Steve Bannon, who was the genius behind Donald Trump's 2016 election, he's actually saying, look, if you've got these two people who are deadlocked at the convention in July, bring in an outsider. Obviously, Mrs. Clinton hopes it's her. Mm. But the other one, of course, would be the former First Lady.
Yes.
Mrs. Obama.
Yes, I know. Even though that she keeps saying that she's not going to do it, but let's wait and see. Elizabeth Warren, who you have liked for years as a candidate, she has withdrawn. But her supporters are still going to be crucial. And in fact, her whole involvement in this campaign to this point has been pretty crucial because it's really set the policy agenda.
Absolutely. And so the reason I've liked her is because she was warning about the global financial crisis well before it took place. So she was a very smart Harvard professor, and she's still trying to focus on the need to help ordinary Americans in financial distress. Mm. The Obama administration rescued the banks. He didn't rescue the ordinary Americans, which is why there's a bit of resistance to preserving the memory of Obama, and of course Biden is capitalizing on that memory, but Sanders is saying that's not going to be enough.
So are her supporters going to go with Biden? Are they going to go with Sanders? Would they go with Clinton?
That's quite
Obama,
crucial,
you know,
isn't
yeah. Where will they go?
I can't imagine they're going to go for Clinton, except, of course, it's a gender issue.
Yes.
If she decides in July to be the person who'll break through the deadlock, at the moment, everybody's just trying to work out where we go from here, including Senator Warren, who's very unclear as to where she wants her supporters to go.
Yeah. Keith, let's move on to Israel now, where voters have just endured their third election in less than a year. It is quite incredible. No party can form a majority parliament there. The voters, the people of Israel, must just be extraordinarily frustrated. Does it look like Benjamin Netanyahu will stay on as PM? This is, of course, despite the fact that he's facing corruption allegations due to be heard in March.
That's right, but it just shows what a flourishing legal system you've got in Israel, and also even the election system. It's a nation of 8 million prime ministers. People feel very passionately about their democracy. And so clearly the nation is divided on this issue, but broadly of a similar point of view. They're not going for a really extremist candidate. So who knows what will happen now. My guess is that he will try to come back as Prime Minister and then still go on trial.
Yeah, okay. All right, that's going to be very interesting to watch, isn't it? Just before you go, I just want to ask you about what is happening in Afghanistan. We know that Islamic State has just taken responsibility for an attack there. This comes in the same week that Donald Trump has signed a deal with the Taliban.
And has spoken to the Taliban leader.
Yeah.
See, he wants to get out before the November election. He wants to be able to say, I've got the Americans out. And he's been in his recent press conference in the last few minutes that just simply said, look, we're going to get out. These people have got to sort out their own problems. So, and he says it may well be that the Taliban do take over control again in Afghanistan.
Another enormous week in global politics.
Absolutely.
We're grateful for your insights as always,
Thank you.
Keith.
I know, when
thank
you ask
much.
Keith how is his week been, he always says the
he
same
takes a
thing.
Deep breath first.
He says, always busy. Thank you, Keith.
Thank you.
Stay with us, still to come on Weekend Sunrise. Can you name Australia's top holiday hotspot? Sydney, Melbourne, the Gold Coast, Uluru, the Great Barrier Reef? Well, think again. We'll reveal the new number one.
It will surprise you. Plus, Hollywood hammered the big budget films being flattened by the coronavirus and why studios have decided now is no time for James Bond.
The new diet drink warning, the ones that can lead to rapid weight gain, why no sugar doesn't mean no waves. Welcome back to Weekend Sunrise. It's time now for the news. Here's Sally.
Good morning. The coronavirus has now infected more than 100,000 people globally as Australia's last night recorded its 64th case. A Brisbane man in his 20s is now in hospital after returning from Iran. It comes as fears grow of a cluster outbreak in Sydney's northwest, where Australia's first school has been shut down because of a positive test result. The New South Wales Education Department is reportedly working to create digital classes, enabling students to log on from home as it prepares for the possibility of a mass shutdown. Wall Street is sharply lower this morning with the coronavirus crisis shaking investor confidence. The Dow Jones was down more than 600 points a short time ago, while in London this morning the FTSE 100 closed down 3.5%. Global fears are having an impact here too, with Qantas yesterday announcing it's reducing some of its flights in response to decreasing demand amid the outbreak. Tasmania is considering culling our iconic kookaburra. The species is considered a pest by many locals, with the birds killing smaller native birds there. Kookaburra numbers have blown out across the island state in recent years. One of Australia's last and best-known World War II veterans will be farewelled today. Sydney's Dick Payton died last Sunday at the age of 99. He served in the Middle East, Borneo and New Guinea, including the Kokoda Track. Dick was well known at Anzac Day services, a regular school speaker, and hailed in New South Wales Parliament this week as a true patriot. His memorial service will be held this morning at Sydney's George's Hall. New research out of the US has found using olive oil could add years to your life. A study has found more than half a tablespoon of olive oil per day lowers the risk of any kind of heart disease by 15%. Replacing just a single teaspoon of butter with the same amount of olive oil also decreases the risk. However, the increased intake did not appear to have any impact for the risk of stroke. The Duke of Sussex has arrived in style at an English racetrack alongside Formula One world champ driver Lewis Hamilton. He was driven to the Silverstone racetrack in Northamptonshire in an electric Mercedes to open a new museum showcasing the circuit's heritage. The racing complex costs nearly $30 million. The visit is one of Harry's final engagements as a senior royal member before he steps down next month. And British PM Boris Johnson has shown us how it's done when it comes to clean hands amid the coronavirus outbreak. His advice, wash your hands for the duration it takes you to sing Happy Birthday twice.
You've got to do two verses.
Two verses.
Yeah,
I think 20 seconds will be
sufficient. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Melodic.
Thank you very much.
Happy birthday to you.
That was once, but I can assure you he did it twice. It comes as Mr. Johnson pledged an extra $90 million into coronavirus vaccine development and testing kits. It is actually, I did try it during the week, an extraordinarily long time.
It's
it was before I scrubbed up for surgery.
But, it's about 20 seconds, but I've been getting my kids to do it.
And of course you have.
Yes, but it's very interesting. Well, otherwise, you tell kids to wash their hands and they and that's it.
We
love
it, but it's a good message. It's a lot longer than it you is, think yes. you
it's
might have been
longer,
required to
twice.
Wash your hands.
But he sung Happy Birthday to the laboratory that he was at. My kids sing their own name as loud as possible, naturally.
And that's a great idea. Here's Simon.
Meanwhile, the dam levels are dropping. Thank you very much, Sal.
Thank you, Debbie.
I had to say it. On the eve of International Women's Day, we celebrate the Matildas' win last night and the Southern Stars, hopefully tomorrow, at the MCG in the T20 World Cup final. And it is very appropriate this weekend to say a very good morning to 7 News sport reporter Michelle Bishop for Weekend Sunrise Sports Talk. Mish, let's start with the Matildas.
Well, a 5-0 win. It was, and let's face it, it could have been more. They had a lot of missed opportunities up there in Newcastle, and what a crowd, over 14,000 people, which was pretty sensational. But Sam Kerr, she led the charge with 2 goals, her first coming in within the first 10 minutes, but her second, quite significant. She became the second highest international goal scorer with 41. That girl is on fire. Mm-hmm. Chloe Legazzo, she also netted one, and a special night for Emily Van Egmond. She potted one in front of her home crowd. She's, of course, a Novocastrian. Now, the return leg is on Wednesday in Vietnam, and let's take it, the Aussies will basically slip through, and it's all a mere formality now as far as the Olympics
you would think so.
You'd
Vietnam
have,
have never beaten Australia.
Absolutely.
So hopefully that's booked them on the spot to Tokyo. That's it, that goes ahead as well.
Plenty of ifs.
Stay positive. In AFLW, the Gold Coast Suns lost to Geelong, sadly, but the men's team had another win of some real substance. They are 2 from 2 in the preseason.
A much tighter affair, and let's face it, all fans are entitled to get excited. but even the ones that copped the wooden spoon last year. So the Gold Coast, as you say, plenty to look forward to. They were much improved, physically tougher, and defensively they look sound. And let's face it, last year they were the easiest side, I guess, to get the ball around. A bit of a worry though, Alex Sexton, who is in a race against time now for round one with an injury. Of course, round one, the Suns take on Port Adelaide. And just a quick mention of Tex Darcy, Fogarty, an exciting prospect for Adelaide.
Indeed, and also the Hawks and Melbourne went at it last night. And for Matt Doran, some good news as well. The D's got up again, Matty. More good news indeed. Fantastic stuff. Well done to the D's. Mish, let's go around the houses in the NRL. You've been busy as you always are this week. It was a big night for an NRL legend last night.
Robbie Farah, 303 NRL games, but he obviously had his testimonial dinner last night in Sydney. You only had to look around the room at who was there. Phil Gould, Tim Manor, Benji Marshall, Shannon Noll, Rodney O, Brad Fittler, right. Paul Sirin, and they were all there. But, you know, his 2015 premiership for the Tigers, he had some highs, he had some lows, he had his stints with Souths, but I think we'll all remember him also for his commitment to the Lebanese community and what he was able to do through that 2017 World Cup. He was absolutely phenomenal, and he's been great. He'll still be sticking around doing some stuff with the Tigers. He's also now the CEO of his own company, 247 Events, and he's selling sporting events around the country, doing really, really well.
Great cultural ambassador. The Dragons, not so good. They're the walking wounded ahead of round one.
Well, wasn't this an odd story? Corbin Sims, he thought he escaped injury in the nines. He was tested, basically examined for a broken arm, and they said it was all good. But he got out of bed Wednesday or Thursday, heard a pop, felt a pain, went to the doctors and it actually fractured his arm. And he, of course, joins Matt Dufty and their skipper, Cam McGuinness, on the sideline. Not a good look for the Dragons for round
Not
one.
Not good. Round one, 1 week away. Finally, it wasn't just Robbie Farah being honoured last night. One of our very own, you love him, I love him as well, was honoured in Melbourne.
The man, the legend. It's the Melbourne Press Club's lifetime achievement for his commitment to sport, Bruce McAvaney. We all love him, let's face it. As I say, he is a legend. I was quite privileged to meet Bruce when I was about 17 working on Sports World as a young researcher. He was inspirational then. He continues to inspire us every day. And, of course, he's front and centre of our racing today.
Very well said. And it is a big day at Flemington and Randwick as well. Yes, he's still the gold standard for broadcasters in sport, Mon and Matt.
He's also a gold standard for men too.
Human being.
He really
exactly.
is the most wonderful yep. human being.
Tough to imagine anyone more deserving, really.
Yep.
Congratulations,
beautiful.
Bruce. All right, well, let's go now to JT in Mammoth Mountain, California with today's weather.
Riding the gondola. You're looking at the Sierra Nevada mountain range behind us. We're at Mammoth Mountain this weekend. We're doing this thanks to Icon Pass, because you can buy one Icon Pass in Australia and you can use that in Thredbo or Mount Buller or 41 different resorts around the world, in New Zealand, in America, in Europe, in Japan. It's a great way to get some great value if you like skiing and snowboarding. If you like boarding, Mammoth is for you. We'll find out all about it after the forecast.
This is Weekend Sunrise Weather.
Possible storms around Cairns, 32 degrees. Stormy at Mackay, showers at Toowoomba and 26 degrees. Brisbane, showers and 29. Sunny in Bourke City, showers and 24. Cloudy in Albury. In Canberra, possible showers today, 22 degrees. Sunny in Mildura, cloudy and 21 for Melbourne. Swansea, light showers, the same for Hobart with a top of 16. Adelaide, sunny and 25. Sunny at Coober Pedy. Alice Springs, sunny and 30. Darwin, possible storms and 33. And in the west, Bunbury is humid today, partly cloudy in Perth and 23. Sunny for Karratha and Broome. Well, Gabe Taylor has lived here for over 20 years. Mammoth Mountain. So some people, I didn't know until a couple of years ago that you can actually ski and snowboard in California.
I know. It's crazy. I mean, I grew up in Encinitas. I grew up on the beach. I grew up surfing. And I had a friend who told me about snowboarding. And we had to go to the mountains. And where are we going? We're going to California. We're going to Mammoth. And I remember driving up the road and seeing these massive peaks, 11,000 feet above sea level. And I was like, that's the biggest wave I've ever seen. And my life changed. You know, I've been here ever since.
So you are not just in the team at Mammoth, but you're also a professional snowboarder. I love your life. We took the board out yesterday afternoon, and for snowboarders, this resort has got nice, big, wide, groomed runs you can just really carve.
Yeah, I mean, it's massive, above tree line, so you have all these transitions and features, natural features all over the mountain. And then on top of that, we have 7 terrain parks, you know, over 150 features. It's built across the mountain, so it's literally a paradise for a snowboarder.
Well, Gabe and the team have lined up some amazing skis and snowboarders for us to see their skills a little bit later on in the train park. So thank you for having us. We're doing a couple of weekends from resorts around the US for Icon Pass. Gabe, Let's get down on these some of these runs.
Yeah, let's do it. We're going to watch some of these kids that are going to be chucking meat over this stuff. It's so fun. The kids are so good, and it's so fun to watch them. So motivating, and it'll be fun.
Chucking meat? I've never heard that term. Give me one more Californian phrase for beer.
I mean, you just don't want a tomahawk. You know, Tommy Tomahawk, that's probably the worst thing you could do, where you fall and you just whoop, 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 down the mountain.
Good tip. All right, guys, we'll see you back here in Huffer.
Chucking meat with a tomahawk. All right, I got it. I'm going to be down with it, with the kids.
You don't sound here's like you're words. All that down with it, but I support you in theory.
Thank you. Soon for you this morning, the 2020 wedding trends, what's in and what's not, and why DIY weddings are the new craze.
Plus the story that keeps rolling on, the toilet paper bulk buying frenzy. What is really behind it?
And the link between smartphone and headaches, the new research that will make you think twice about how you use yours. That's coming up next on Weekend Sunrise. Well, it's the news that we don't want to hear but can't ignore. A group of Chinese scientists is warning that COVID-19, better known as the coronavirus, has mutated into a more aggressive strain. In a new study published in the National Science Review, they claim that after crossing into humans, the original strain evolved into a second type, and both are now circulating in the community. Sunrise GP Ginny Mansberg is here. Good morning to you, Dr. Ginny. What do you make of this research?
So it was only 103 patients, all of them from China. So whether we can extrapolate that to the over 100,000 people in the world who now have this virus, swab confirmed, I'm not sure. But what was interesting was it did start as this S type, and then it changed to what we call the L type. And because the L type was more common, they're going, oh, it's probably more aggressive, but they don't really know that. And what they're saying is these days we're seeing much more S type growing again. That's of 103 cases. Whether we can extrapolate that to Australia, Italy, Iran, we don't really know. I would just watch. It's a watching brief. I don't think we're seeing it actually mutate. Plus, what they're saying is once you've got immunity to one, you've still got immunity to the other anyway. There is cross immunity. So it's not like you're going to get it again and again and again with more aggressive types. Not at this stage, at any rate.
We trust you, Jin. So sometimes it's hard to just make out what is panic and what is something that we should listen to. What is your opinion about how worried we should be?
Look, it's got the potential to be what we call a pandemic. Well, it kind of is already. It's jumping from person to person in multiple places. What becomes really scary is where we can't really contact trace. We don't know where person X, who's the new index case for a new area, actually came in contact with it in the first place. And if that continues to happen, we've got to assume that it's going to be really rife in the community until we all develop our own innate immunity enough to just fight this off so that it's like a cold or a flu.
It's like the herd immunity that we hear about.
Correct. So right now, because none of us have met this virus before, all of our bodies are completely, we have no immunity at all. And so that's where the risk comes in, particularly to the older, to the elderly, to the people who've got underlying lung disease, who are the ones who are in hospital.
We keep being told Australia is a great place to be if you are going to contract this, that our health system is great.
Yeah.
What are you finding in your surgery? A lot of people coming in concerned about it, wanting to be tested?
Yeah, so we've got people coming in who've got a sore throat, have not had any contact with anybody with coronavirus, who have not travelled anywhere and they want to test for it. It's not that simple. The testing procedure is reasonably rigorous, and if we test you, we've got to put you in quarantine. But you don't qualify for a test unless we ring a public health unit and get advice. Getting onto a public health unit, in my experience over the last few days, has been just nothing short of a car crash. You can't get on. You're waiting. You've got people in isolation rooms for 4 hours, 5 hours, waiting for them to call back. They don't call back. They call back, they tell you they can't deal with you right now because the person's in the wrong area, you're in the wrong area. It has been nothing short of a Keystone Cops. But, we're trying to make the best of what is a very difficult situation.
Okay, wash your hands, people. Yes. Wash your hands, wash your hands. Absolutely. Cough into your elbow
or into
a tissue.
Cough into your hand and then go shake someone's hand.
Yes, indeed. All right, now, just quickly before we let you go, researchers have discovered a link between headaches and smartphone use. So, interesting. Do you think that this is a strong enough link?
Look, this study was a bit rubbish. I mean, it was done in India. They basically got 400 people on the phone, which is not a big number, and they go, hey, how much do you use your smartphone? Hey, how many headaches do you get? Okay. Hey, do they go away with a Panadol? Now, I don't know about you, but I have got no idea how much I use my phone.
No.
I'm not very good at recalling my headaches over the last 4 weeks. I don't think I get many. So already this research is a bit suspect. But we kind of think probably people who use a lot of their smartphones have that turtleneck.
Yeah,
and they do get more headaches. They get more neck strain, they get more eye strain. It probably is true, but I wouldn't say that this study is the be-all and end-all for that kind of research.
So is it not a bad thing to just remember, okay, try and remember your posture while you're looking at it and perhaps you might get less headaches?
Well, we definitely know you get less headaches if you stand up than if you sit down because you tend to sort of, you don't look down as much. And also I think it's so uncomfortable to raise your hand that you sort of stop using it as much. That's possibly why. It's a lot about the neck.
Yeah, all right. Terrific. Yeah. Well, thank you, Dr. Ginny.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it. Here's Matt.
Thanks, Mon. Well, coming up on Weekend Sunrise, are you starting to lose your hearing? How it could be linked to dementia? And can it be fixed? Plus, your chance to win a holiday has never been better. Tips to improve your odds even more. And Australia's best ice cream has been announced. But what flavour ice cream has risen to the top? On the Sunrise news feed this morning, the coronavirus crisis dominates headlines again with reports that schools are preparing to start virtual classes so students can stay at home and learn. And Kensington Palace is reportedly preparing to cancel Prince William and Princess Kate's royal tour of bushfire communities. Joining us this morning, social commentator Gretel Colleen and former Senator Darren Hinch here at Brekkie Central. Thank you and good morning to you both.
Morning. Welcome, Darren.
Thank you.
We've already seen, Gretel, one school closure in Sydney. We're seeing it, if you look at the impact on education across the world of the coronavirus now, the UN's calling it virtually unprecedented, 300 million students affected. Should we be bracing for virtual classrooms here in Australia?
Yes, but I don't think we should be using terms like bracing. I think we're quietly preparing.
Right.
And that's exactly what this announcement from the Education Department has been doing. It's saying we've got a plan in place. Staying calm is really vital during this. And the whole toilet paper escapade has shown there is something fundamentally wrong with our society that we're competing with each other.
All education departments should be preparing for this.
Exactly.
I mean, Japan has just announced they're closing all schools for 1 month. So they should be prepared for it. And if kids have to learn at home for 2 or 3 weeks or whatever, has to be.
But isn't that something we have to brace for, Gretelby? I mean, talking parents too, you've got to look at the flow-on effect of wages and childcare. How do you digitise a system at short notice?
Well, they've already started preparing for that. So they actually, it's not like, whoa, let's digitise the system now. It's in place. They're gearing it up even more over this weekend. There is going to be something for every family to think about. Who's going to look after the children when they're not at school? Mm. Can we share? Can we have some sort of community group that looks after the children? How do we stop the sharing of germs there?
And when childcare centres start to close down, so mum and dad are working, somebody's going to have to stop working.
France has jumped in and said they'll supply 14 days paid leave to parents if they have to, if they have to stay at home and look after the children. But it's going to be a big issue economically as well.
It is, but we're going to be able to deal with it. Even in the particular article, one of the ones that we were reading this morning, it used the phrase "they're deploying laptops." Deploying. It's not. That is a term that is usually used in military, conversation. We need to remain calm, and I do want to stress this ridiculousness that has gone on with toilet paper is something that our society needs to look at. Because where is the conversation about, have you checked on your neighbour? Have you checked on the person with a disability who might not have been able to go to the shop? Have you checked on someone who doesn't necessarily
speak
English?
But look at all the stuff this morning now, in makeup this morning.
Yep.
I came and kissed you on the cheek.
I know, and I loved it.
But, that's just habit. I saw a thing on Twitter yesterday, a health minister overseas, and she was reading a list of don't touch your face and don't do this. And as she turned the page, she licked her finger. We sort of ruined the whole argument.
It was brilliant, wasn't it? The bombshell here is that Darren Hinch has makeup. I've never heard all that. That's quite
a... He was in there for hours.
Oh, was he really?
And a wig.
Yeah. I've got Ray Martin wig.
I don't believe that for a second. I want to move on to another really divisive topic, this one. This is the Courier Mail reporting that a police officer has successfully sued an insurance company. This for post-traumatic stress disorder. Been awarded $1.1 million payout here. He sued the insurance company of a driver involved in a horrific accident. And it cost that driver's life. Gretel, do you believe this sets a precedent for emergency service workers who suffer from PTSD? It's going to be a big flow-on effect.
Well, it went through every level of our court system. There were appeals and this has been the outcome. It's fascinating because it appears, I'm very, with my amateur perspective, that it perceives him to be a victim of the car accident also. And that's really interesting because where does his employer come into this? How does insurance fit into this? Because ultimately, in a situation like this, that's a normal person's insurance premium.
Yeah. Look, I think the court's got it right. I think that it hasn't been enough done for police and emergency workers like this. I mean, journalists, you know, see horrible things over the years. We never had any human services or any help at all. I think they're right on this one. The sidelight to it too, of course, is that in Victoria, the Justice Party, my party, is we're pushing hard to try and get the Premier to enforce the idea that if you attack a policeman or an emergency service worker, a paramedic, you get 6 months jail. You get it. No ifs, no buts. The Premier promised it, but it hasn't happened. There's been people in walking, magistrates letting them walk. But in this case, this policeman, I mean, the man lost his legs. He was on drugs and booze and whatever.
A cocktail of drugs
cocktail.
And he was travelling at speed.
And his parents were looking for him, and he turned up. So the copper has got a legless man dying in his arms with the man's mother in his company, so he went through hell.
He did go through an enormous amount, and there's no question about that, but this is not an isolated incident. And I think what our system needs to be aware of is what is the ripple effect of this. As we know, whether it's any emergency service or anyone who's deployed in a war...
But the insurers come to saying, suck it up. That was their defence.
Saying that the police should be prepared for this, should be trained for
part
this.
Of your job training is that you can handle this sort of stuff.
I mean, it's interesting that his employer was not held to be responsible.
It's only applicable where the driver can be at fault, these claims. So it's an interesting discussion. Unfortunately, we're out of time. Thank you very much, Doran, and also Gretel. It's 8 o'clock. Our top stories this morning.
Breaking overnight, Australia's 64th coronavirus patient, a man admitted to a Brisbane hospital after returning from overseas. 100,000 cases now worldwide as cruise ship passengers, including Australians, are left stranded, anxiously waiting for test results.
Happening now, virus rationing. Supermarkets take drastic steps after panic buying strips shelves bare. This morning, the expert explanation for the hysterical scenes.
New this morning, royal tour in doubt. Prince William and Kate's international travel under review as Qantas joins other airlines in cutting overseas routes to stop the virus spreading.
Also this morning, health alert, the truth about diet drinks. Scientific research revealing how they could be changing your metabolism to actually put on weight.
Plus, competition bonanza, the unprecedented number of holidays up for grabs, tipping the odds more in your favour.
Don't miss DIY weddings, the 2020 trends that are changing the day, the bridal wear, and culling that ever-expanding guest list.
Plus, the woman who stopped Celine Dion in her tracks.
I hold you in my arms and never let go. I surrender.
See what Celine did next on Weekend Sunrise this Saturday, the 7th of March, 2020.
Right across Australia, this is Weekend Sunrise. Now live from Brekkie Central, Monique and Matt.
Good morning and thank you so much for joining us on Weekend Sunrise this Saturday. Also this morning, Kookaburra Cull, the state where our lovable laughing birds are considered to be a pest. Now, action is being considered to stop them nesting in the old gum trees and, in fact, to cull them.
Very controversial indeed. And honouring a legend, a special night for Channel 7's Bruce McAvaney as his lifetime of contribution to Australian sport is recognised.
But our top story this morning is the coronavirus, and it's reaching a dramatic new level with more than 100,000 cases now confirmed worldwide.
Serbia has just recorded its first case, meaning 90 countries are now infected globally.
Kensington Palace is reportedly reviewing William and Kate's international travel over virus fears, putting their Australia tour in doubt.
64 people here now have the potentially deadly virus after a 28-year-old Brisbane man was admitted to hospital following a trip to Iran.
And it comes a day after the first Australian school was shut down as fears grow of a cluster outbreak in Sydney's northwest. There's no word on when Epping Boys High School will reopen.
Students from the Epping School, they rode around this street and are living in this street.
This morning it's reported the New South Wales Education Department is urgently moving to digitise learning.
That would enable students to attend virtual classes from home in the event of a mass shutdown of the public school system. And right now, there's a really anxious wait among cruise ship passengers who'll learn very soon whether they've tested positive to COVID-19.
Let's go live now to 7 News US correspondent Amelia Brace, who is in San Francisco. Now, Amelia, do we know when these passengers are going to find out?
Well, Mon, one of those passengers is actually texting me as we speak, saying that the captain is currently providing an update, though it remains unclear whether that does include those test results. What we have learned is that 45 people on board were tested for coronavirus. Concerns were raised after three people from the first leg of this ship's voyage contracted the virus. One of them actually died. 62 people from that first leg continued onto this second leg. So as a result, all 3,500 people, including at least four Australians, have been forced into quarantine and told to stay in their rooms, as one passenger explained to me.
They're not having any contact with us. They will not come in our rooms and make up the rooms or turn down the beds. They're strictly just handing from door to door.
And also this morning, the captain has put out a call for anyone on board who might need prescription medication beyond tomorrow to fill out a form so that that can be airdropped onto the ship. That obviously is not a good sign in terms of how long they anticipate they may be stuck out at sea.
Not a good sign at all. Tough to even imagine how tense it is for those passengers on that ship. Thanks to Amelia Brace there for us in San Francisco. Here's Sally now with the rest of today's news.
Good morning. Global share markets have taken another blow with the coronavirus crisis shaking investor confidence. The Dow Jones opened sharply lower but rallied, closing just over 100 points lower a short time ago. In London, the FTSE 100 is also falling, down 3.6%. Aussie markets closed lower yesterday with fears of a major economical flow-on effect. Meanwhile, Qantas has joined other airlines, reducing some flights in response to decreasing demand amid the outbreak. Flights from Japan, Hong Kong and Auckland will be scaled back. Tasmania is considering culling one of Australia's most iconic birds due to overpopulation. Kookaburra numbers have blown out across the island state in recent years. The species is considered a pest by many locals, with the birds killing and displacing smaller native birds, including endangered species. The state's main wildlife rescue director has told News Corp it needs to happen in a humane way. The Duke of Sussex has geared up with six-time Formula One world champ driver Lewis Hamilton to open a new museum at an English racetrack. 7 News Europe correspondent Sarah Greenault joins us live from London. Good morning, Sarah. He certainly arrived in style.
Good morning, Sally. He sure did. He was actually driven there by Lewis Hamilton to open up the Silverstone Experience, which is this new immersive museum dedicated to British motor racing. Harry is a bit of a racing fan. When he was there, he was talking to the kids and getting very involved in some of the interactive displays. He actually first went to the British Grand Prix at Silverstone back in 1994 as a nine-year-old little boy with Princess Diana. So perhaps somewhat fitting that this is one of his last official duties as a royal before he makes that final getaway and races off to Canada. He and Meghan have a couple more events over the weekend. They have that Commonwealth Day service on Monday before they essentially quit. And today they also released some photos on their Instagram account showing they've made some time for some secret solo appearances as well. Meghan there visiting the National Theatre in London where she is a patron.
And Sarah, there are also reports this morning that Prince William and Kate's Australian tour is in doubt. Can you explain why that is?
Yeah, Sally, well, due to the coronavirus, Kensington Palace is reportedly reviewing their travel plans. When they go overseas, Kate and William travel on commercial flights. The events they do obviously draw these big, big crowds, and they love meeting and greeting with people, which obviously involves handshakes, something that is strongly being advised against at the moment. So they're not going to cancel this tour, rather postpone it. Keeping in mind, we still don't actually have any official dates, any itinerary yet, but the Australian government seems to think it will still go ahead, as well as meeting with hero fireys and bushfire survivors. This tour is also going to be about promoting Australian tourism, and we all know how much the industry will need that once this outbreak is contained. Sally?
All right. Thank you very much. Sarah Greenough reporting for us there. A Gold Coast plumber may have missed his calling as a footballer after tackling a suspect in mermaid waters. The 35-year-old was walking his dog when he spotted a police chase. He acted quickly, tackling the fugitive and holding him down until officers arrived.
I said, "Is that it? Can I go home?" And he goes, "Yeah, mate." Gave me a high five and I walked back across the bridge. I'm no hero or anything like that.
Cool as a cucumber. The suspect is facing a range of charges after ramming an undercover police car and nearly running over an officer and school children. Ian has been offered a lifetime supply of thongs after losing one in the tackle. Well, you have heard of beer on tap, but for some very lucky residents in northern Italy, they have experienced wine flowing from their faucets. A piping malfunction at a local winery mistakenly introduced Lambrusco into the town's main water supply. The winery has apologised, I don't know why, saying there was no hygienic or health risk to the community. Some residents, though, of course, complained it was fixed too quickly.
Of all the things that could go wrong, that is brilliant.
It's so medical!
Yeah, Northern Italy needs something happy at
the
moment.
Yeah, they do.
That is brilliant.
Hopefully.
One way to get people not worried about the coronavirus.
Hopefully exactly. Residents get stocked drunk. Up. Yeah.
A fair bit of collective praying went on there for that wine. I think it's come through the tap. Very good.
And just lastly, in keeping with the theme of treats, Australia's best tasting ice cream has been crowned at the Australian Grand Dairy Association Awards, and it's not chocolate, it's not strawberry or vanilla, it's licorice.
No,
this is a thing.
Refused to believe.
The Darren Dairy Farm in northeast Victoria has taken out the honours.
Oh, but that ice cream is delicious.
It's taken out the honours in previous years too.
Which isn't delicious? No, I mean that's true.
But that brand licorice. is particularly yummy. It's just licorice.
No, it doesn't do it for me.
It's like fresh in dessert.
I guess it'd be a bit salty too.
It shouldn't go in ice cream either. Do you like licorice?
No.
But we know that while this desk doesn't like it, there are plenty of people out there, like
no
my dad.
One actually cares what we it. Like. That's, or no, just like, really, true. Because the jury has spoken.
They probably do care
now
about sport.
We never agree on anything, but we agree we don't like licorice.
It's the first time we've agreed on something. Okay,
the Matildas
say I like it.
Have taken a big leap towards Olympic qualification after beating Vietnam 5-0 in Newcastle last night. Superstar Sam Kerr all smiles as the Matildas captain scored twice to become the team's second highest ever goal scorer. The Aussies made light work of the world's number 32 ranked team, all but assuring a place in Tokyo.
Obviously, we were not as sharp as we'd like to be in some points, but 5-0, good performance by a lot of girls.
Well done, Sam. The return leg comes in Vietnam on Wednesday. Geelong have kept their faint AFLW hopes alive after a strong win over the Gold Coast Suns last night. The Cats now sit fourth on the ladder after coming from behind to beat the Sunnies by 20 points.
Bouncing through. Now, is that score? That is a goal to Rocky right on the siren.
In the men's comp, the Suns are sweating on the fitness of Alex Sexton. The forward limped from the field in their pre-season win over Adelaide. A suspected hamstring there. Young hawk Mitchell Lewis carried off with an ankle injury, while Demon Sam Wiedemann also hurt his ankle in the victory. Well, Scott McDonald finally got his name on the score sheet as the Brisbane Roar beat the Wanderers 3-1 last night. The former Celtic frontman hadn't scored for Brisbane since moving from Western United in January, but McDonald was in sparkling form, scoring twice in the first half.
Cross deflected, tap in, Scott McDonald at the double.
Western Sydney captain Mitch Duke kept his five-game scoring streak going, but it wasn't enough to prevent the loss. We all want to be JT right now.
We certainly do. He's not in a magnificent
licorice.
Part of the world. If it's a bit warm where you are this morning, take a look at where we're headed for Saturday's weather forecast. JT is on Mammoth Mountain in California. JT, how on earth did you convince him to give you that gig?
With my new mate, Duke. I'm pretty grateful for it. It's an icon pass I've sent us over here. You can buy one pass. It works in 41 different resorts around the world. One of them is Mammoth, and you can come and meet Duke, as they say in America. Duke. He is a six-year-old field golden retriever avalanche rescue dog. Nicole looks after him. How often do you train him and what sort of training do you do?
So we do training every day. Some of our training is just basic obedience, getting the dog to come outside with you, sit, stay, listen to all the commands you want. Yep. And then a couple times a week, we'll also go out and do mock search scenarios where we actually bury a person under the snow in what's sort of like a snow cave and have the dog go and look for the human under the snow. The dog doesn't know where these humans are, and they just go out and use their noses to find them.
What a clever boy. And have a look at this other great trick he does. This is a snowball. Hey, Duke. Oh, don't leave me hanging, man.
Duke. Oh, here we go.
Come on.
Oh,
ready?
Well, he eats it.
Woohoo!
And he gives it back every time.
Just doesn't get old.
Wow. And he's your ball. He goes, good boy. Good boy. Come here.
He good should boy. Only be called Duke.
Let's have a look at your forecast. That first one didn't quite happen.
This is Weekend Sunrise Weather.
A slow-moving trough is generating rain and storms in eastern Queensland and northeastern New South Wales, with a trough and cold front bringing showers a few showers to southeastern New South Wales. Other troughs are causing a few showers and storms in southern WA and the northern tropics. In Brisbane, showers in 29. Sydney, showers in 24. Canberra, possible showers in 22. In Melbourne, partly cloudy in 21. Light showers in Hobart and 16 degrees. In Adelaide, mostly sunny and 25. Humid in Perth and 27. Broome is sunny and 35 today. Stormy in Darwin and 33. And Alice Springs, a top of 30. Scott, explain this scenario.
Well, this is how we're going to transport Duke to the avalanche site. He's on my shoulder, and hopefully he stays there when we ski away.
Hey, Duke, good to meet you, mate. See you later. So this is how they get to a site when the dog needs to get there really fast. They ski them there. Ah, isn't that a beautiful picture?
That is
dogs,
sheer genius.
Skiers, snowboarders, incredible mountains. Ah, it is a good place to be. We are very happy to be here. We'll see you back here in half an hour, Matt.
We're living vicariously. Thank you, JT. Well, the panic buying of toilet paper, rice and hand sanitizers has now led to supermarket rationing as stores struggle to replenish their shelves following, well, pretty astonishing scenes that many people are still struggling to truly understand. Limits are being put on how much can be purchased in a single transaction. For toilet paper, for example, it's 4 packs. So is all of this just adding to anxiety over the coronavirus, or will the pictures cause people to stop and think about how it all looks and what it all means? Mel Taylor is an associate professor at Macquarie Uni who specialises in the psychology of pandemics and disasters. Professor, thank you so much for joining us today.
You're welcome.
I'm really interested in your insights into, I guess, what is driving these behaviours. Firstly, what's your take on I guess, the pandemic? Mm-hmm. Will we see, I know you've spoken about preparedness for perhaps 14 days of isolation.
Yep.
And do you think we'll see a scenario in Australia where schools will be shut down?
Obviously, it's hard to tell, but it's looking pretty likely. So I think, as in all good emergency management, the best thing to do is to be prepared for whatever you're going to face.
And you think 14 days of isolation is something that's looming, is quite real?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we're already seeing, you know, the start of outbreaks happening in schools. And I think, you know, we know that the symptoms can be very mild and very hard to pick up. So I think it's inevitable that we will get more of these cases, and there will be schools shut down and there will be families staying at home.
You can tell us about what's actually driving the psychology behind the clearing out of supermarket shelves and the hysteria we're seeing in a lot of supermarkets. Do you think it's rational?
Yes, I do, actually. And I think I'd like to take a bit of a punt at the panic word, the P word. It's sort of, because in risk management and messaging, you know, our words matter. And I think what we're seeing is not panic. We are seeing a mix of behaviours, certainly, and we're seeing the very antisocial behaviours that we're seeing time and time again on the videos we're seeing, which make it look like, you know, there's a lot of panic going on, or there's a lot of unfair and selfish behaviour. But actually, the majority of people, I believe, are doing what we would want them to do in this situation, and that is they're starting to prepare. And just like we have early adopters of technology who get out early and start taking, you know, the action that's required, we, in this case, have got people who are preparing early. So some people have started already. And the toilet paper is, I guess, the most obvious visually to us in the supermarkets, because they take up so much supermarket shelves that it doesn't take many people to take them for you to notice the gaps. And that, of course, then means that those people who perhaps thought they were going to get round to this are thinking now, oh, I should do something. So they'll take something maybe a bit more impulsively at that point rather than having prepared it. But I think, you know, in terms of being rational, I think there's lots of thought behind it. So in that respect, it's definitely rational, even for those people who are taking a lot of it, because they've got other agendas and they're thinking quite rationally about those agendas too.
It's interesting to hear you saying that you think it's a rational response as someone who has an expertise in pandemics, because a lot of people say it's just completely crazy how we're responding here. Do you think the messaging is right that we've been seeing from the health department, from the government? Are we being appropriately alerted to, I guess, the severity of this outbreak?
Yes, I think we are. And I think the fact that we're seeing this behaviour is actually evidence of that. I mean, people are engaged in this because they can see it's real and they're listening to the messages, and they are listening to those messages around, you know, in this case, stocking up for the potential they might have to stay at home for a while. We're being told very clear messages around hygiene and social distancing, and those messages being repeated across different sort of states and territories by the chief health officers. So we're getting a clear message at this point.
Professor, are we in new territory here? I mean, you study pandemics. Mm-hmm. You're better familiar with outbreaks than most. We haven't seen anything quite like this. Where do we go to from here? How bad does this get?
I mean, no, we haven't seen this sort of thing before. I think we do need to hang on to the positive aspects that this is not the Hollywood scenario. You know, we're not looking at large proportions of the population dying as you do in Hollywood films. What we're looking at is a lot of people potentially getting the virus. Most of those people will have very minor symptoms, may not even realise they've got them. But of course, because we know this is easy to catch, a lot of people will become sick, and a proportion of those people will need some sort of hospital care. And so therefore, we really need to make sure that we do what we can to contain and slow down the spread so that the hospital systems and the healthcare workers and the GPs can cope with that.
And the education department
too.
Of course,
yes.
Yeah, it's going to be a big challenge for a number of sectors and a bigger challenge for the economy, of course. Professor, thank you very much for your insights this morning. Very
You're
grateful.
Welcome.
Here's Mon.
Thank you, Maddie. Good chat. Now, it turns out Australians have gone bananas for Coffs Harbour. The community on the New South Wales mid-north coast has been voted number one in What If's 2020 Aussie Town of the Year Awards. And it's coming at just the right time for the town, perhaps best known for its big banana, in a region that's rebuilding from bushfires and bouncing back from drought. And one local absolutely thrilled with the accolade is the Mayor of Coffs Harbour, Denise Knight, and she joins us now from, well, where else? The Big Banana, of course you are. Good morning, Denise. Congratulations. Listen, I've heard you say that Coffs Harbour is the most beautiful place in Australia, so is it any surprise that Coffs Harbour would take out this top gong?
Well, good morning and welcome to paradise. No, I don't think any of the locals were that shocked about it, because we all live here, we all know what we've got to offer. So it is truly a paradise.
Well, Denise, my dad and my stepmum live in the area, and it is absolutely beautiful. Apart from the big banana, this is your opportunity to tell the rest of Australia what Coffs has to offer and why it took out this top gong.
It's probably a lot faster to say what we don't have to offer, which is nothing. We've got it all. We're cradled between the, you know, mountains meet the sea. We've got 60 kilometres of pristine beaches. We've embraced our Aboriginal heritage here. We've got everything that you could possibly want. So you could do outdoor adventure, so you could get on your trail bike and off you go, or push your bike through the mountains and the bushes. Or you can just laze around on the beach. So we've got magnificent food, we've got wine, we've got beer, we've got great accommodation, and we've got the beautiful jetty foreshores. So what don't we have? Zero.
Well, look,
so we've got it all. Welcome.
Lots of people.
And we are open.
And a very enthusiastic mayor to boot. Look, lots of people are thinking about their holidays this year. They're cancelling overseas trips. We know that interest in Coffs Harbour is up 120% already, year on year. How are you faring, say, from the bushfires and drought?
Look, unfortunately, the fires last year were unprecedented, and we did have a lot of damage done to a lot of our area. And the floods, well, it was sort of minimal. But look, at the end of the day, we urge all Australians to holiday here at home, particularly Coffs Harbour, We've got a wonderful community here. We welcome you with open arms. But, yeah, let's support a lot of our regional areas because, you know, we've done it tough. So come on, stay with us and have a great time.
Yeah, we actually have the ability here to make a really meaningful impact on local communities if we spend our money here in Australia. I just have to ask you about the Elton John concert that rocked the town just last week. Apparently someone actually went into labour during Tiny Dancer. Is that right? Or is that a myth?
No, it's not a myth. It really did happen. So Elton John was here for two nights at the beautiful CEX Stadium, and her waters broke and she was taken to hospital and she had a beautiful baby boy.
Wow.
So it is not a myth. It is true. And Sir Elton John was kind enough and lovely enough to send a package
to her.
We're
seeing that now.
At our beautiful hospital. So we've got a hospital here that is a health campus and, you know, it was great. It was a real, you know, it was just a lovely thing to happen, I think. But I don't know, she was pretty game going to a big concert that close to
good
having
for
a baby.
Her. That is fantastic. If you want to bring on labour, that's one way to do it. How gorgeous. Apparently he doesn't have a name yet, the Barb. I would have thought that Elton or John or, you know, something.
Coughs, I know.
Banana.
Or sir.
Yes, exactly. Would factor somewhere. Denise, congratulations. Really happy for you. It is such a beautiful region. So well deserved. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And right. Our community absolutely deserves it.
Yes, indeed they do. The most lovely locals ever. Thank you so much, Denise. Well, still ahead for you this Saturday on Weekend Sunrise. Competition bonanza, the unprecedented number of prizes up for grabs, tipping the odds of winning more in your favour.
DIY weddings, tradition out the window in 2020, a new favourite day, new bridal wear, and the new way of managing that ever-expanding guest list.
Are you starting to lose your hearing? How it could be linked to dementia and how it can be fixed?
The truth about diet drinks. Science reveals how you could be fooled into actually putting on weight.
Plus, the woman who stopped Celine Dion right in her tracks. I hold you in my arms and never let go. I surrender. Not sure what that reaction is. Stay with us, though, to find out what Celine did next. You're watching Weekend Sunrise. Back in a moment.
This is Weekend Sunrise on 7. Now back to Monique and Matt.
Still to come this morning on Weekend Sunrise, the unprecedented number of holidays up for grabs in a competition bonanza, where to find them, and the best ways to look like that. And look, you just explode with champagne. That's what all my holidays are like.
Very excited face. Plus, DIY weddings, tradition, well, it's out the window in 2020 as the day, the outfits and the guests lists all get an overhaul.
Lots of us in that. And are you starting to lose your hearing? What? There could be a link, a really serious link, actually, with dementia. Can it be stopped? We're going to look at that. But right now, it's 8:30, time for the latest news with Sal.
Good morning. The coronavirus has now infected more than 100,000 people globally as Australia records its 64th case. A Brisbane man in his 20s is now in hospital after returning from Iran. It comes as fears grow of a cluster outbreak in Sydney's northwest, where Australia's first school has been shut down because of a positive test result. The New South Wales Education Department is reportedly working to create digital classes, enabling students to log on from home as it prepares for the possibility of a mass shutdown. Meanwhile, Wall Street closed lower this morning with the coronavirus crisis shaking investor confidence. The Dow Jones opened sharply lower but rallied slightly, down 257 points at close. While in London this morning, the FTSE 100 closed down 3.5%. Global fears are also having an impact here too, with Qantas yesterday announcing it's reducing some flights in response to decreased demand amid the outbreak. Tasmania is considering culling our iconic kookaburra. The species is considered a pest by many locals, with the birds killing smaller native birds. Kookaburra numbers have blown out across the island state in recent years. One of Australia's last and best known World War II veterans will be farewelled today. Sydney's Dick Payton died last Sunday at the age of 99. He served in the Middle East, Borneo and New Guinea, including the Kokoda Track. Dick was well known at Anzac Day services. He was a regular school speaker and hailed in New South Wales Parliament this week as a true patriot. His memorial service will be held this morning at Sydney's George's Hall. New research out of the US has found using olive oil could add years to your life. The study's found more than half a tablespoon of olive oil per day lowers the risk of any kind of heart disease by 15%. Replacing just a single teaspoon of butter with the same amount of olive oil also decreases the risk. However, the increased intake did not appear to have any impact for the risk of stroke. The Duke of Sussex has arrived in style at an English racetrack alongside Formula One world champ driver Lewis Hamilton. He was driven to the Silverstone racetrack in Northamptonshire in an electric Mercedes to open a new museum showcasing the circuit's heritage. The racing complex costs more than $30 million. The visit is one of Harry's final engagements as a senior royal member before he steps down next month. Britain's PM Boris Johnson has shown us how it's done when it comes to hand sanitation amid the coronavirus outbreak. His advice, wash your hands for the duration it takes to sing Happy Birthday twice.
You've got to do two verses.
Two verses. Yeah, yeah, I think 20 seconds will be sufficient.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Melodic.
Thank you very much.
Happy birthday to you.
It comes as Mr. Johnson pledged an extra $90 million into the coronavirus vaccine development and testing kits. And a huge congrats to Channel 7's own Bruce McAvaney, the legendary sports broadcaster, was honoured with the Melbourne Press Club Lifetime Achievement Award at the Quill Awards last night. Bruce has covered every Summer Olympics since Moscow in 1980 and remains our industry's gold standard sports anchor and commentator. No one can rock a skivvy like that outside
skivvy?
Of the
Wiggles.
It wiggles
was
either.
It a white skivvy?
Strong skivvy look? Action, very strong hair action, and yeah. Just an all-round legend of the industry.
Deserves well, it done, more.
The thing about Bruce is he actually really cares about
he
what he's talking about. Yeah. Like, it is totally genuine.
But he also
genuine.
Has an encyclopedic knowledge of yeah. every
and he works
sport.
Hard.
But most importantly,
yeah,
that's skivvy.
I mean yeah.
if you can pull that
man.
Off, you yeah. should obviously
a
win every award available.
With
do you know what skivvy?
You know
no
the
less.
red skivvy isn't as good as the white skivvy, is it? I mean, it's good, but
no,
it's not
no,
as
it's
good.
No, it's the white that
it's
sets
the white.
It.
But it's the gumption. It's the gumption required to wear a skivvy like that. That I'm admiring.
I don't think it dates at all, Bruce. You just look fantastic.
You
sport
are
now with Simon,
something else.
Who has aged a bit? No kidding.
Oh, she can't help herself.
Sally, she do you remember? Hang on, sorry, Simon.
It sat underneath.
No,
it sat underneath
Sal,
that
do you remember? Thing. Do you remember you had that conversation?
Yeah,
you said, "I'm not
going
to be mean
Simon.
To Simon anymore."
You
Simon.
Were right on the wall,
you
Sally.
You couldn't do it.
Be mean.
Sport now. I'm sorry.
You're very youthful, Simon. Please continue.
You're amazing.
The Matildas are on the verge of Olympic qualification. After thumping Vietnam last night, Captain Sam Kerr became the team's second highest international goal scorer, scoring twice in the 5-0 rout. The return leg in Vietnam on Wednesday. Mitchell Starc will fly home early from the Australian men's tour of South Africa so he can be at the MCG to cheer on wife Alisa Healy in tomorrow's Women's T20 World Cup final. The men play the final one-day match against South Africa. The series is lost tonight. Melbourne captain Jack Viney may be in some strife, Matty, after a dangerous sling tackle on Hawthorn skipper Ben Stratton in their pre-season win. Matt says he's fine. Both teams also have injury worries. Hawk Mitchell Lewis and Demon Sam Wiedemann hurting their ankles in the game. Geelong has kept its faint AFLW finals hopes alive after coming from behind at halftime to beat the Gold Coast Suns by 20 points. The Cats sit fourth now on the Conference A ladder. Happy girls. Australia will take a 2-0 lead into day two of their Davis Cup qualifier against Brazil. John Millman came from a set and a breakdown to win his match while Jordan Thompson got the tie off to a winning start, beating Thiago Montero. It's a sport.
Montero. Is pronounced. Okay.
You must say it like that, Montero.
Montero.
Certain amount of flair that comes with that. Thank you, Simon.
Head thing as well.
JT has our weather for us today from a very special part of the world, Mammoth Mountain in California.
And you keep saying that you're living vicariously through me. And Mon, I know you're not particularly into skiing or snowboarding.
Just because I can't do it.
I found something for you.
Yes.
Where are we, Em?
We're in the classroom right now at McCoy Station. There is wine tasting here, and it's going on until the middle of March.
Have a look at this view. It is incredible. You could sit here happily all day and just take that in over an après ski beverage. Let's have a look at your forecast.
This is Weekend Sunrise Weather.
Cairns, possible storms in Mackay. We're in for some storms as well. Showers in Toowoomba and Brisbane, showers in the top of 29. Bourke, sunny in 29. Sydney, showers in 24. Partly cloudy in Albury. Canberra, possible showers in 22. Mildura, sunny and 25. Melbourne, partly cloudy in 21. Swansea, light showers, and in Hobart, 16 degrees. In Adelaide, mostly sunny, 25. Sunny at Coober Pedy. In Alice Springs, sunny and 30 degrees. Darwin, possible storms in 33. And in the west, Bunbury, humid today. In Perth, partly cloudy in 27. Karratha, sunny and 37. And Broome, sunny and 35. Mon, if you're not into wine, well, you might be into cocktails.
Of course.
This is Penny. She's from New Zealand. This is Christine. She's from Auckland. And this is Naree. She's from Mackay.
Hi.
Good morning to everyone in Mackay. Have you told Mum to watch?
Yes, but I'm not sure she'd be awake.
Oh, I hope she is.
Hi, Mum.
Now, what's the skiing been like this morning?
It's good. We're finished now, so we celebrate with a drink at the end of the day and take the gondola home and keep it safe.
what's your tipple of choice?
It's a little can of bubbly.
A little can of bubbly. How delightful.
Celebrate our first day on the snow together.
Well done. Congratulations. No breaks or bruises?
Nothing. No.
No stacks?
No.
Well done. Means you're not going hard enough, doesn't it? Penny, what do you love about working here in Mammoth?
Oh, I get a gorgeous view out there. Everybody's skiing. I get to ski myself quite a lot, and I meet lots of interesting people.
And these guys are so great. We sort of said, look, can you just keep this area clear? We're going to come over while we're reading the weather. And Naree was just chucking. These guys have just purchased all of these snacks. I'll just go over to these guys. They've just purchased all these snacks, and Naree's just chucking it over the top of them. Sorry for interrupting your bar experience there.
No, not at all.
See, that's the Kiwis and Aussies, that's how we do it. We just...
They chuck them. That's
it.
We just chuck them.
Good conditions out there today?
Oh, awesome. So fun. A little slushy, but still the best.
Now time for a little après ski, hey?
Yeah?
Yeah.
Ready for it.
Well, cheers. Bottoms up. Have a good afternoon. We'll see. Let's have one last quick look out the window.
Wow.
That is what Penny's talking about.
Wow.
This is Mammoth Mountain in California, USA, part of the Icon Pass range. You can get an Icon Pass and you can get access to 41 different resorts around the world. And we're pretty happy to be there.
Looks magnificent.
JT, you guys. Do you know what? There, I can totally see a reason to go there. The one time that I went skiing, I pretended that I had an injury. And I spent the whole time in the bar with the other people.
You
that
faked
had the
an injury.
I faked an injury, and then I would forget which leg I was limping
this
on.
This doesn't surprise me at all in any way.
That looks amazing, JT. How gorgeous.
Did people believe
right.
you?
Yeah, until the more drinks I had, then I switched up which leg was the limp was on, the injury was on. All right, moving on now. And the global pandemic might have some of us settling in for staycations this year, but perhaps it could be time to reconsider your travel plans with an unprecedented number of overseas holiday giveaways up for grabs right now online.
It could be your best chance to win a once-in-a-lifetime trip. That is, if you're game enough to travel overseas, whether it's finding paradise in the Pacific Islands or a cultural cruise through Europe, there are plenty of competitions to choose from. Craig Seatham from competitionsguide.com.au is here to tell us more. Craig, good morning. You're seeing a spike in the number of travel comps coming your way. Tell us a little about this trend.
Well, normally we see Australian competitions and overseas competitions around about on a par with each other. And over the last couple of weeks, all of a sudden, we've noticed that the amount of overseas competitions to some pretty fantastic locations has actually doubled. And not only that, the really unusual thing is the number of cruise competitions that has close to triple now, which is quite exciting for us.
Yeah, except, I'm sure everyone's thinking what I'm thinking right now. Oh, is that a tough sell right at the moment, a cruise?
Well, I guess it could be seen as that. And the way to explain it is that if any industry is doing it tough, it's not unusual to see that particular industry, whether it's cars or even caravans at some stage, of coming out with more competitions because it's an easy way to get into the market very quickly. So with cruises, Normally we expect to see about 6 to 7 cruise competitions at any time at Competitions Guide. As of this morning, we've got 15. And it seems like the trend is continuing. And some of these locations and even the values of cruises that you can win are fantastic.
So, Craig, let's get into the best of them. What are the, would you consider some of the best prizes currently available for some of these competitions?
Well, normally I'd be talking cars and big cash competitions, but I'm going to go back to cruises because that's the topic of the moment. We've got some fantastic European river cruises, and those ones always seem to be incredibly expensive. We've got a couple of beauties at the moment, and also the some cruise competitions where you can win one of six or even one of three. We launched one this morning where you can win three cruises, all Australian based as well, so nicely close to home. So really worth having a look at because the odds of winning are a lot better than they normally would be.
Okay, and you've got some tips for winning?
The first tip that I will always come out with is to join a competition website because the hard work is always done for you, whether that's Competitions Guide or one of our friendly competitors. Enter three or more competitions a day and that will keep you above the pack. The more competition prizes that are on offer, the better chances of winning, and ones where there's some effort or a purchase required are always good. But here's one that I haven't actually used before, and that's that we've really noticed a trend that weekends are usually the time that competitions close, either Saturdays or Sundays. So really keep an eye out for closing competitions on the weekend and your chances of winning are that much better.
Good stuff.
Good advice, Craig. Thank you very, very much for your time.
Thank you.
Moving on, apart from the family home, it's one of the biggest outlays a couple or their parents will make. And for many, it's one of the biggest days, of course, of their lives.
So when we think of a traditional wedding, a white dress, the church setting, something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue, all come to mind, don't they? But hang on a second, this is 2020. Today's brides and grooms are rewriting the rules. So what's in, what's out, and what are the modern day tricks to doing it on a more reasonable budget? Well, Victoria Black is the publisher and editor-in-chief of Modern Wedding. Welcome to you, Victoria. So we're seeing that the average wedding these days costs $45,000.
Wow. Yes.
That's a hell of a lot.
That's a lot of money.
Are there ways, or do give us your sort of insight in how you can try and cut that down or keep the costs to a minimum?
Sure. Well, there are loads of creative ways that you can actually cut your budget without spoiling the wedding whatsoever. For example, Saturday night weddings are what most people do. And so lots of places and lots of vendors are booked out on a Saturday night for many years to come. So by making your wedding on a Friday night, which is becoming really, really popular, or even midweek, that can save a lot of money and you can still have your dream wedding. And that also gives you the benefit of spending the whole weekend with your family, if they've come into town.
Is there any way to get around, as soon as you say it's a wedding, the dollars just add up, don't they? You know, even when you're looking for flowers, everything. Is there any way to get around that?
Not really, because brides are demanding and to create
what
a
about
beautiful
the grooms
wedding.
Are demanding too,
yeah,
let me tell you.
Demanding.
The blokes are, the blokes can be even more demanding.
And not all brides are demanding.
No, that's true. But it's a lot more effort to create a wedding than it is to have a birthday party, for example. So I have heard people say, oh, just don't tell them it's a wedding, but no, you can't do that.
Right. Victoria, one of the things I like in terms of trying to keep costs down for these weddings, some people are putting their guests to work with DIY projects, helping to make it more affordable. How's that work?
Yes, well, for example, for your kitchen tea or your hen's weekend, you can make that a really fun DIY activity. And most girls love doing that sort of thing anyway. So you can help make the invitations, help do the place cards, the decorations of the table, even get involved in making, you know, floral decor and wedding arbors and all sorts of things.
Wow, which women do you know?
Sneak the work in.
One of my friends who would like to do that. I'd like to go and drink the champagne.
That's right, yeah,
for sure.
Oh, there's plenty of champagne while you're doing it.
Now, the
worry.
Other thing that I always think is a good idea, when people have a destination wedding, because that automatically cuts out heaps of people.
Exactly.
That's a good idea, isn't it?
Oh, it's a great idea. Yes, if you get married, even destination weddings in Australia, it certainly does cut down the people that will come. So that can help. And, you know, you have your wedding and your honeymoon all in one, which saves money too.
You're getting some good ideas.
Oh, yeah, this has been very educational, extraordinarily. Well, I'm not sure what the inference is, but I'm taking notes.
Yeah, good. Perhaps you can ask this next question, because I know you want to know.
Can I ask you about fashion trends for 2020? I'm right across this.
Of course you are.
So, some twists on the modern gown, Victoria.
Yes, well, we just went to the bridal showings in Australia to see what's coming up in the next year. And wedding
jumpsuit. Matt was at that too.
It's taken a lot of my time this year.
Well, they're amazing, those dresses.
Yes, colourful dresses, wedding jumpsuits. Like, colour is really exciting. You can wear... pistachio is the new white. That's what we're saying.
Pistachio is the new white.
Pistachio is new white. I'm hearing that everywhere, Victoria.
And beautiful pink.
Sounds a little nutty.
Oh, I like the pantsuit. That's a good idea.
Oh, jumpsuits are fantastic. And you can really glam them up with gorgeous jewellery and diamante belts. And you can have a really unusual wedding.
Is this all part of the styling
wedding.
Trends of this year?
Yep, styling trends. Well, they fall into two camps. So on one side, we call it the bold and the beautiful. Think Kim Kardashian, super glam, glitzy, over the top, can't have too much, right? Mm. And then on the other end, we've got the very subdued, sophisticated wedding. Understated, a less is more kind of approach.
More in the Kim Kardashian realm.
That's definitely, yes. Loads of ceiling florals, as you can see.
Oh my God, that looks amazing.
Chandeliers galore, which you can hire.
That one's understated.
Well, there you go. Look into pistachio wedding dresses and put your guests to work.
That's it.
That's
and
the take
the other thing is you can cut your guest list down.
Yeah,
so today's brides and grooms, they don't want all the cousins that they never see.
How many? What's the magic number?
120 wedding.
No, that's hard.
I'd like 20.
No, but that's hard because it's usually, most people have got a partner, so that's only 60. That's 30 each.
Just
that's
elope.
Not easy.
That's
not many.
Just elope.
I know. No, we can elope. Oh. We're all coming in the pistachio dress. You won't be wearing that, will
we'll
you?
We'll talk about that.
Okay. Thank you, Victoria.
Thank you so much for having me.
Be sure to see Matt at the next Bridal Expo, I'm sure.
Yes.
I'm excited for that.
We'll link up. I'll be there with my notebook.
Awesome.
Thanks so much, Victoria.
Thank you.
Well, if you're middle-aged or beyond, listen up, because one in six Australians are affected by hearing loss, yet many people ignore the problem until it's too late and the consequences could be far worse than you may think.
Worryingly, if the issue isn't addressed by the time you reach your 50s, there is a higher risk of developing dementia. The good news is that there's help available and it is free. Joining us now, ear, nose and throat surgeon Dr. Kathy Berman and Ali Allen Edwards, who suffered hearing loss from birth but wasn't aware because he didn't know any differently. Good morning to you both. Thank you very, very much for being here. Alan, could you tell us how discovering, of course, about this hearing loss, it must have quite immensely changed your life.
Look, the loss crept up on me. I've had it all my life, as you said, and everyone's hearing loss is different. For me, the hearing loss became very painful. Mm. I mean, I lost bits of words, so I could always hear things, but they were just sounds sometimes. And so as that got worse, I mean, I've had hearing aids for over 18 years before I got cochlear implants. And as that hearing loss got worse, things just became harder. It became difficult to even walk into a shopping centre. I mean, I love shopping. But, I mean,
like a needless confession.
I couldn't go into the shopping centre because I'd be in there for 2 minutes and then just the noise would get to me. And it got to the point of in the morning, you'd put the hearing aids on and it would just start ramping up. And so I'd become anxious and just stressed about that whole thing.
So you've got a cochlear implant now and you've touched on something where is this link to dementia, I think, where we're seeing that people are becoming less connected, perhaps if they've got the wrong hearing device or they're unable to hear at all. So just tell us about that link with dementia, because that's fascinating.
Yeah, look, The Lancet in 2017 published a big article showing that hearing loss is linked with dementia, and in fact hearing loss in middle age is potentially the most preventable factor that we could step in with and prevent dementia. So even mild hearing loss for 60 and above has 2 times the risk of developing dementia over the next 10 years. Mm. Moderate hearing loss, 3 times the risk, and severe hearing loss, 5 times the risk. So we really want to step in middle age particularly, and treat hearing loss to try and prevent some of the sequelae down the track.
Right. It is Hearing Loss Awareness Week, and so these messages that you're bringing us today are vitally important. You're saying it's preventable. What are some of the key things people should look out for, some of the key things people can do?
Well, I think as Alan mentioned, it becomes really hard hearing in background noise. So people are often finding it harder to hear at cafes or restaurants or at the shops. Mm-hmm. People then can find that they're just slowly withdrawing from social activities. People might find it hard to hear on the phone, or they might find it hard to hear children's voices. And hearing loss leads to sort of withdrawal, social isolation. It can be a factor in depression and anxiety, and as we mentioned, dementia. So we really want to step in early and treat it with hearing aids or cochlear implants if necessary.
Alan, correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is that a cochlear will actually take away any of your natural hearing that you might have. It replaces it if you're lying.
It replaces it totally, but it's different. It's not. It's a different world. It's not bad.
Yeah.
It's just different. It takes a while to get used to, but the peace and calmness that I got with it. I mean, a lot of, not just the hearing. I got words back. I mean, my biggest problem now is I can hear everything, but I've still got to learn to listen better because over the years I'd given up being engaged.
Yeah.
So right. I'd just withdrawn and I'd lost that contact. So to me, it's a beautiful gift. And the Sydney Cochlear Implant Centre and that group, awesome.
They are amazing.
What they do with anyone from babies right up to adults, it's just fantastic.
Well, they give you your life back.
It is. It is the greatest gift, and I get very emotional talking about it. It is just unbelievable.
I can understand
why. It's amazing to watch. It's quite significantly changed your life.
Personally, I mean, everyone's different, but personally, it's just been amazing.
Well, if that's not reason enough to go, and if you think that you might have an issue, go and talk to your GP as a first step.
Yeah, I think that... Sorry.
Yeah, go. Yeah.
Certainly talking to your GP. There are hearing apps, so the World Health Organization produced Hear Who, so you can do an app to see as a screening test, and then certainly have a hearing test with an audiologist, a proper hearing test. But also you can go to hearingoptions.com.au to sort of look at your options.
Terrific.
Really important messaging this morning. Thank you very much to Cathy and to Alan for coming on.
Thank you for inviting us, guys.
How joyfully you and eloquently you put it. It's beautiful.
Look, it's just something that's just really, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, it's great. It's great.
Continue
great
to enjoy
able to
listening.
Share that.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Alan
thank you.
And Cathy.
Well, moving on, and the downturn in the movie industry from the coronavirus has already begun, with reports of cinema audiences in drastic decline. This week, the highly anticipated new James Bond film became the first major blockbuster to have its release date pushed back. That, of course, due to the outbreak.
Now, as more big releases hang in the balance and film and TV shoots are abandoned, it's feared the industry could lose the equivalent of $7.5 billion. And Weekend Sunrise movie man Jason Jabber-Davis has more on the Hollywood's real-life horror.
It's the action-packed blockbuster James Bond fans have been waiting 4 long years to see.
Name?
Bond. James Bond.
So you're not dead?
Hello, Q, I've missed you.
Now they're going to have to wait even longer after the release of No Time to Die was delayed due to action to stop the coronavirus pandemic.
Cinemas and multiplexes have become ghost towns, pretty much, and the revenue has evaporated along with it.
The film's official Twitter account posted, "After careful consideration and thorough evaluation of the global theatrical marketplace, the release of No Time to Die will be postponed until November 2020. It came after an online plea from Bond fans to push out the release date for the sake of public health. The spread of coronavirus has hit Hollywood hard.
Disney's new CEO estimates a $175 million loss in the last 2 months, and the uncertainty continues from day to day.
China is the world's second biggest movie market, but since January, all of its 70,000 cinemas have been closed.
The Chinese box office in the last 2 months is down 99.7% over the same time last year.
The release of some films in China has been postponed indefinitely, including Sonic the Hedgehog, 1917, Little Women, and Jojo Rabbit. The shutdown is also expected to have a catastrophic impact on other high-profile releases.
My father cannot fight, so I will take his place.
One of the biggest is Disney's upcoming live-action remake of Mulan, which reportedly cost $300 million to make.
You will die pretending to be something you are not. Yet here I stand, proof that there is a place for people like us.
It was expected to make big bucks in the Chinese market. Now Disney may be forced to delay the release date.
Asian and European revenue is vital to the Hollywood studios. So if films like No Time to Die or Mulan are delayed for too long, that not only costs momentum for the audiences, but dollars for the studios.
All right, Dom. What's next?
Another big budget blockbuster set to feel the pinch is the ninth installment of the Fast and Furious franchise, F9, due for release in May.
I came here to take you down, little brother. That's your mistake. This is my world.
The last film in the franchise, The Fate of the Furious, made almost $600 million in China, almost double what it made in the United States. It's not just movie releases that are being affected, but also production.
The entertainment industry is feeling the fallout of coronavirus, and TV and film production has crawled almost to a halt.
Filming of Tom Cruise's new Mission Impossible flick in Venice was put on hold due to the coronavirus outbreak in Italy. One of the few winners in this crisis seems to be TV streaming services, with viewers shunning cinemas and staying at home.
Fears of contracting coronavirus are keeping moviegoers out of the theaters, and the question is, will they ever come back, or will they just stick to staying home and streaming?
No one knows how big the coronavirus crisis is going to get, but for now, some of Hollywood's biggest movies are hanging in the balance.
Wow, once it hits Hollywood, then it really gets our attention,
doesn't it?
They're
already struggling with streaming as well. Wow. It's going to be tough.
All right, it's time for pop news now. Here's Sal. Good morning. Well, a confident fan has serenaded Celine Dion in New York. The young woman spotted the star as she was about to drive away and belted out one of Celine's classic songs, I Surrender.
I still believe I'll make you give them all to me. I hold you in my arms and never let go. I surrender.
Look, it was not the fan who was making headlines, it's Celine's facial expression as she watches on silently. Oh, look, Celine is all of us sometimes. We all have that moment.
I can't decide whether she really loved it, really hated it.
No, she loved it.
But that if that's a face of joy, then I would hate to see a face of anguish.
Well, she was just working it out. Okay. She was working it out. Thank you, Sal. That was lovely. A lovely story. Still to come on Weekend Sunrise. The truth about diet drinks, how the food you eat with them can cause an unexpected result.
Plus, enough is enough. The public ban being enforced following vile comments about AFLW players.
And what's wrong with this ad? The offending scene that was so bad, it was taken off the air. But right now it is 9 o'clock and it's time for our top story this morning. The coronavirus has reached a dramatic new level with more than 100,000 cases now confirmed worldwide.
Serbia has just recorded its first case, meaning 90 countries are now infected globally.
Now, Kensington Palace is reportedly reviewing William and Kate's international travel over virus fears, putting their Australia tour in doubt.
64 people here now have the potentially deadly virus after a 28-year-old Brisbane man was admitted to hospital following a trip to Iran.
And it comes a day after the first Australian school was shut down as fears grow of a cluster outbreak in Sydney's northwest. There's no word yet on when Epping Boys High School will reopen after a Year 11 student was confirmed to have the virus.
Student from the Epping School, they rode around this street and are living in this street.
This morning, it's reported the New South Wales Education Department is urgently moving to digitise learning. Now, that would enable students to attend virtual classes from home in the event of a mass shutdown of the public school system. And right now, four Australians remain on a quarantined cruise ship off San Francisco.
Let's go live now to 7 News US correspondent Amelia Brace in San Francisco. Now, Amelia, last time we spoke to you, we understand that passengers were being given an update. Do we know what they were told?
Yeah, they finally did get that update, Mom, but it did not have the information that they were hoping for. The captain still does not have those test results. He says that he understands that these people, 3,500 people, are getting cabin fever after being told to stay in their cabins for the foreseeable future. But at this stage, he just cannot let them go outside. Here is a recording that one of the passengers sent to me.
We will certainly let you know the results as soon as possible. We apologise for this delay, which is outside of our control.
We know that 45 people on board have been tested for coronavirus. The alarm was raised after three people from the original leg of this ship's voyage actually contracted the virus. One of those people died. 62 people from the first leg of the voyage continued on to this leg of the voyage to Hawaii, and there are now fears that they could have contaminated the whole ship. We've heard the captain also say that anyone who needs medication beyond tomorrow should put in a request. So that is obviously alarming for these passengers to hear as they wait to hear exactly how long they will be in this holding pattern about 90 kilometres off the coast of San Francisco.
And the agonising wait continues. Mm. Thank you very much to Amelia Brace there for us in San Francisco. Here's Sally with the rest of today's news.
Good morning. Global share markets have taken another blow with the coronavirus crisis shaking investor confidence. The Dow Jones opened sharply lower but rallied, closing just over 250 points lower a short time ago. In London, the FTSE 100 is also falling, down 3.6%. Aussie markets closed lower yesterday with fears of a major economical flow-on effect. Qantas has joined other airlines, reducing some flights in response to decreasing demand amid the outbreak. Flights from Japan, Hong Kong and Auckland will be scaled back. Tasmania is considering culling one of Australia's most iconic birds due to overpopulation. Kookaburra numbers have blown out across the island state in recent years. The species is considered a pest by many locals, with the birds killing and displacing smaller native birds, including endangered species. The state's main wildlife rescue director has told News Corp it needs to happen in a humane way. The Duke of Sussex has geared up with six-time Formula One world champ driver Lewis Hamilton to open a new museum at an English racetrack. 7 News Europe correspondent Sarah Greenalch joins us from London. Sarah, he arrived in style.
Sally, Harry was chauffeured to this event by Formula One champion Lewis Hamilton. He was there to open up the Silverstone Experience, which is this new immersive museum dedicated to British motor racing. Harry is a bit of a racing fan himself. He first went to the British Grand Prix back in 1994 as a nine-year-old boy with his mum, Princess Diana. So perhaps somewhat fitting that this is possibly the last thing he will open up as a senior working member of the royal family, with he and Meghan stepping down at the end of the month. This is being called their farewell tour. They have a couple more events over the weekend, and then on Monday, this big finale, the Commonwealth Day service at Westminster Abbey, which will be attended by the whole family, including the Queen, and many right across the world will be watching that very closely. Today on Instagram, the couple also released some photos of Meghan yesterday making a secret solo visit to London's National Theatre, where she is a patron. Meanwhile, this morning, we are hearing fresh reports that Kensington Palace is reviewing William and Kate's travel plans, which could affect their bushfire tour in Australia. When they travel overseas, the couple travels on commercial airlines. They do these big events that attract huge crowds, and they love doing the meet and greets with people, which includes handshaking, which is obviously being discouraged at the moment. They're not cancelling the tour, they are just postponing it, but also keeping in mind we still don't have any itinerary or any official dates, although the Australian government has said they are coming. In addition to meeting with hero fireys and survivors of the bushfires, the couple will also be promoting Australian tourism, and we all know how much the industry will still need that once this outbreak is hopefully contained.
All right, thank you, Sarah. Well, there are calls for a Queensland plumber to become the new Gold Coast Titans forward after a spectacular tackle which ended a police chase. The 35-year-old was walking his dog when he took a fugitive down and held him in place until officers arrived.
I just sort of waited till he got close, turned around, gave him the old coat hanger and a bit of a wrestle for a few seconds, and he pretty much gave up. So then I just sat on him, and the policeman came jogging up and put him in cuffs, and I said, is that it? Can I go home? And he goes, yeah, mate, gave me a high five.
Cool as a cucumber. He's been offered a lifetime supply of thongs after he lost one in the tackle.
His name's Ian as well. I'd like him on the Melbourne Demons.
How good's that?
Definitely.
He can play in thongs too if he attacks it with that level.
How good a term is coat hanger as well.
Yeah, I think the high five is my favourite bit of that story.
Yes, it is. It's very Aussie, this story. And just finally and very proudly, Seven News has scooped up several honours at the Aquila Awards for Excellence in Journalism held in Melbourne last night. Revered broadcaster Bruce McAvaney has been honoured with the Melbourne Press Club Lifetime Achievement Award for his outstanding contribution to Australian sports broadcasting. Seven News was also recognised for rolling coverage of the George Pell guilty verdict, being first to report the news live from outside the court. The judges commended the thorough reporting by all the team, including Mike Amor, Chanel Vella and Nick McCallum. Congratulations to all the team.
Well deserved.
Good people, all of them.
Yes, indeed.
Much more deserving than us, for example, than me.
Well, we weren't up for anything. But.
We never are. The Matildas are one step away from qualifying for Tokyo 2020 after beating Vietnam 5-0. Superstar Sam Kerr, all smiles as the Matildas captain scored twice to become the team's second highest ever goal scorer.
At speed, and Sam Kerr on the end of things. Australia with a goal 10 minutes in on the road to Tokyo 2020.
The Aussies made light work of the world's number 32 ranked team, all but assuring a place in Tokyo, the return leg in Vietnam on Wednesday. The fitness of a number of key players is up in the air. A fortnight out from the start of the AFL season, the Suns' Alex Sexton limped off the field in their pre-season win against Adelaide in Noarlunga with a suspected hamstring injury. Young Hawk Mitch Lewis was carried off with an ankle injury, while Demon Sam Wiedemann also hurt his ankle in their win. In the AFLW, Geelong has kept its finals hopes alive, a 20-point win over the Gold Coast Suns.
Bouncing through now, is that score? That is a goal to Rocky right on the siren.
Good on you, Rocky. The Cats sit fourth in Conference A. Bring on Scott night. McDonald got his name on Brisbane Roar's score sheet for the first time in their 3-1 win over the Wanderers. The former Celtic frontman hadn't scored for the Roar since moving from Western United in January, but McDonald was in sparkling form, scoring twice in the first half of the match.
Cross deflected, tapped in. Scott McDonald at the double.
Western Sydney captain Mitch Duke kept his 5-game scoring streak going, but it wasn't enough to prevent defeat. And not a good night for the Waratahs, a better night for the Brumbies, and an average night for the Reds in the Super Rugby as well.
Okay.
You're up to date.
Thank you,
Simon. We are. Thank you so much. Now, JT is going to bring us up to date with all of the fun going on at Mammoth Mountain in California. Good morning again, JT.
Good morning, Mon. Morning, everyone. How great is it bumping into Aussies in Australia? So we just bumped into Nari from Mackay. This is Ben Wisner from Killarney Vale on the New South Wales Central Coast. Good morning.
How's it going, mate? Good.
Now, this is great. Look at these guys behind us. Who are we looking at here?
This is the Mammoth Snowboard team coming through.
Epic. So these guys, I guess if you grow up on the Central Coast of New South Wales or Mooloolaba or Mackay, you take your kids to surf lifesaving. If you grow up in Mammoth, you'd bring them to the snowboard team.
You sure do, yeah. If you live in Mammoth, you're a member of the team. You come up, you ride every 5 days a week. And if you're from Southern California, you come to Mammoth to snowboard.
So Ben was a very handy surfer, tried snowboarding and never looked back. And now you're coaching all of the snowboarders here in Mammoth. And you've coached some Australian Olympians.
Yeah, actually, I've kind of pulled back on the coaching, but last Olympics I was with Kent Callister and Emily Arthur for Australia, and they made finals in halfpipe.
Good stuff. Well, we're going to see some more amazing tricks, but let's have a look at the national forecast around Australia first.
This is Weekend Sunrise Weather.
There's a slow-moving trough generating rain and storms in eastern Queensland and northeastern New South Wales, with a trough and cold front bringing a few showers to southeastern New South Wales, and other troughs causing a few showers and storms in southern WA and the tropics. In Brisbane, showers and 29. Sydney, showers and 24. Canberra, possible showers and 22. Melbourne, partly cloudy in 21. Light showers in Hobart and 16. Adelaide, mostly sunny and 25. In Perth, it's going to be humid and 27. Sunny in Broome and 35. Darwin, possible storms and 33. And in Alice Springs, 30 degrees. Now, tell us about what we're looking at here.
Well, we're looking at the young kids hitting the pole jam.
Hey, for an Australian who's been living here for 12 years, why did you like Mammoth? What brought you to California?
Look, I travelled all over the world and I was looking for a place that had a lot of snow and that laid-back feel like Australia, and California's it. You know, Mammoth Mountain, you can't beat it.
It is absolutely stunning. I mean, the beautiful thing about doing Australian breakfast TV from America, it means that it's sort of 2.30 in the afternoon here, 2 o'clock, 2.30, and it is just a beautiful blue sky day here today. Let's get one. Oh, there's no one else up there. Ah! This guy, we'll get this guy, but it's not like he's killing it. He's just rolling down. Hey, Ben, great to meet you, man.
Good to meet you, too.
See you back here in half an hour, guys.
Thanks, JT.
Cool, fun, thank you. Well, before you take a sip of your next sugar-free drink, here's something that you might want to know. Or maybe you don't. A new study on sweeteners has revealed that ordering a diet drink with your carb-filled meal can actually lead to weight gain.
The findings show that it's not the drink alone that packs on the kilos. It's what you eat with it that changes your metabolism. Sunrise nutritionist Susie Burrell is here to discuss. Susie, good morning.
Good morning.
Many people think that opting for diet drinks is the healthier choice. That's actually not the case. Tell us why.
Well, we've known for some time that the artificial sweeteners or even some of the natural sweeteners found in diet soft drink appear to play havoc with our appetite regulation. And so in this study, they found that even when people compared it to a regular soft drink, which has got about 9 teaspoons of sugar compared to zero sugar in a sweetened soft drink, it still really affected the insulin levels, the glucose levels long term. And what we think happens is the brain gets a little bit confused. So you're having this very sweet tasting drink, of course, because sweetened drinks can be up to 200 times sweeter than sugar itself. And the brain then sort of realizes it's not having this sweet food, but it's already compensated. So it really does play havoc. Now, we know that fast food meals are poor for a number of reasons. They increase inflammation. You can consume an enormous number of calories in a short period of time. But this suggests that having the diet soft drink does not make it any better for you, and ideally will avoid those foods altogether. And it's the combinations they're sold in, and upsized, of course, with a larger burger and larger drink, particularly bad for our metabolism long term.
It was a very small study. They only looked at 45 people. But from what you know and your advice, does it matter what carbohydrate we're eating with the diet soft drink? Because I'm just noticing you've got a nice grainy bread on the next podium.
Without a doubt, the fast food varieties are the worst because it's the most processed carbohydrate, that really sugary, glucosey bread that dissolves in your mouth. So absolutely, if it's better quality carbohydrate, that is a must. So this is a whole grain sourdough loaf. But if you're downing it with white bread and sourdough, plain sourdough at coffee shops, Turkish toast, it remains an issue. And I think the thing with diet soft drinks is, if you're having them occasionally because you're wanting something to quench your thirst, you've had a hot day, it's not an issue. What we're talking about is the habitual users who are drinking litres of diet soft drink every day. And that tends to be the habit. You start to have that very sweet drink once a day and then you're craving it 3 or 4 days later. So the message is you don't want diet soft drink, and definitely not regular soft drink, to become a habit. And that's particularly important for our highest consumers of soft drink, which is actually teenage boys. And what we know is they consume almost 700 mil on average per day, and that just grows over time and they become that habitual user. So the less of it we have in our diet, the better.
To it, you know,
because
you
it primes the brain to want more sweet food. And that's very powerful research, and now also from a metabolism perspective, the less we have in our diets, the better, whether it's regular or even diet soft drink.
And Susie, some fresh warnings about energy drinks as well.
Now, the thing with energy drinks is, again, a lot of young people consume them. They've got close to 11 teaspoons of sugar per serve and the equivalent of caffeine of 2 strong coffees. Now, again, an occasional use by an adult, not an issue. But when we're looking about young people and getting into that habitual use, if you've got underlying heart malfunction, you've got atrial fibrillation, which is that unsteady heart rate, these can be particularly dangerous. And, of course, with younger people, we don't know if those medical conditions are present. So for parents to be really mindful of if the kids are having the V's and the Monsters and the energy drinks, because they're getting a huge amount of sugar. And in the case of the diet varieties, it's not better again because they're being exposed to all that intense caffeine without anything to buffer it. So be very mindful of how they're used, how often you're having them, because they can become habits very quickly.
Just quickly before you go, is there any healthy alternative to an energy drink? Because some people love them.
Well, you're actually better to have a green tea drink, even if it's an iced green tea or a matcha tea, because that will give you the same stimulatory
effect. It's a tough sell to the teenagers, and put down the Monster and pick up the green tea.
Absolutely. Or even, you know what, a coffee's better. Because in many cases, you're having a cappuccino, a latte with some milk. It's going to be a million times better and give you that buffer. It's when they're these formulated drinks, which are really just giving you nasty amounts of sugar or sweetener and then massive amounts of caffeine, that is a problem, particularly for young metabolisms.
All right, Susie. Thank you so much. Someone's just asked to eat that McDonald's. You bought it last night.
Make sure they microwave it at a really high temperature. We don't want food poisoning throughout the Sunrise crew.
I'd just love to have seen you last night at McDonald's buying
that.
It's very rare for you to to have a burger podium. It's extremely rare. I was a little overexcited.
I was walking through the supermarket with my soft drink and someone looked at me and I thought, oh, I hope they haven't.
It's not a good sign. So it's for a segment.
Exactly.
It's a what not to do.
Exactly.
Thank you, Susie. Ahead on Weekend Sunrise, comedy royalty. We can't wait for this. Ben Elton is joining us on the new minefield for stand-up comedians. The jokes that are now off limits, or are they?
Plus, what's wrong with this ad? Why ANZ's been ordered to take it off the air. Melbourne's Herald Sun newspaper has switched off the ability of readers to comment on AFLW stories. News Corp says constant trolling, harassment and really disgraceful commentary has forced this move.
The paper says players, commentators, clubs and fans had asked for the shutdown, telling readers that commenting on stories is a privilege and not a right. Let's bring in our Masters of Spin now, advertising and marketing experts, gurus no less, Jane Carrow and Adam Ferrier. Good morning to you both.
Morning.
Janie, we'll start with you. Look, we know that you get some of the most vile comments online. I mean, I don't mean you in particular, but any story can. But anyone does. You know, a story that you cannot even imagine will get vile comments. Women's football. Like, why would people even bother? You know, they're doing their thing. It's just awful. Do you support the Herald Sun's move?
Yes, I do. And happy International Women's Day for tomorrow on this story. Yeah, it's really distressing. There's been research done over and over that women online get much higher levels of abuse than men do, women journalists do. But in particular, I think women sports people and women sports teams get really vile, sexualised abuse. We saw that fantastic photograph of Taylor Harris and the appalling stuff that was said. It is a real indication of the misogyny and sexism that is still alive and well in our society. Good on the Herald Sun, I think they're right.
It was a national disgrace, actually, the commentary that followed that particular photo. Adam, do you agree with News Corp and the statement here that commenting on stories is a privilege, and do you expect we might even see this broadened beyond just, for example, women's football?
Yeah, and I don't think I do agree, actually. And I think it reeks of patriarchy, to be honest. I reckon the comments should be incredibly tightly monitored. No antisocial or negative comments should get through. And that means if it's only one comment in 1,000 gets through, then so be it. But it should just be tightly monitored, just as the men's game is monitored. And no harmful or destructive or sexist commentary should be allowed on.
But it's Adam, a good job. Adam, the problem is that they've a lot of these organisations just don't have the money. They don't have the staff to put someone on to do that. So how do you get around that?
That's their problem. That's what I reckon the solution is. And if they want to support the game, then that's what I'll be doing to support it. But I wouldn't just be shutting down the commentary on one side and then letting it go on the other. Or shut it down for both.
Yeah, it's an interesting debate, that's for sure.
That's really difficult, that one, actually, you do with that, because there's no media organisation is going to put someone on to tightly monitor the comments like that.
The comments would be monitored already, it's just to what degree they would. And what I'm suggesting would take a lot more manpower and a lot more expense, but if they do want to support the game, then that's what they need to do.
Yes, well, that's very true, Jane.
People power, indeed.
Yes.
To another topic that's been making headlines, ANZ Bank has had a television ad removed from the airwaves because it's in breach of health and safety guidelines. The offending images are a baby wearing a bonnet being laid down to sleep. Ad standards ruled that it goes against sudden infant death advice, as babies' heads should not be covered. Adam, are you surprised something like this gets through checks, actually goes to air?
If me and my wife was involved in the making of this ad, there's no way we would have had the bonnet on that child. And so I am quite surprised that it's happened. By the same token, it's so innocuous and so small, I kind of think it's a little bit well gone mad as well. But so I'm kind of on the fence on this one.
Yeah, Janie, what do you think?
Oh, look, I think somebody searched and searched and searched for a reason to get this particular ad off air. It's a really good ad, and I know what the ANZ's trying to do. It's amusing, it's really warm and human, and it's normalising something that some people don't want normalised. And they've found a flaw. And it is also so difficult when you're making an ad to check on everything that people care about. I once got an ad, had to be re-edited because someone said that there was a bite taken out of a sandwich. I mean, honestly, you have no idea.
That is deeply offensive.
Yeah, that is a big deal.
I can understand that one.
It was I have great sympathy for ANZ. I think it's an excellent ad. I wish it hadn't been taken off.
Yeah, look, the other side to that, Janie, is I know having interviewed some doctors around SIDS, and they say even, you know, we just need to get those messages through, even when we see babies putting put on their fronts or other things being put, you know, in a cot, we just shouldn't do it. So people just get used to a cot is should be completely empty.
I hope they re-edit it, take the bonnet off and redo
the
ad. Right
and then the awareness that comes out of the removal of the ad makes it worthwhile.
Yes, exactly. And if there's any students of advertising watching, never edit an ad with a bite out of a sandwich.
No.
Thank you both.
Hell will descend.
Thanks, Adam. Thanks, Jane.
Cheers, Scott.
Still to come this morning, a racy royal as his royal duties race towards an end. Harry hangs out with Formula One champ Lewis Hamilton.
And singing to Celine.
1,000 dreams I still believe. I'll make you give them all to me.
The singing superstar's reaction to this really interesting sidewalk serenade soon on Weekend Sunrise. Welcome back to Weekend Sunrise. It's time now for the news. Here's Sally.
Good morning. The coronavirus has now infected more than 100,000 people globally as Australia records its 64th case. A Brisbane man in his 20s is now in hospital after returning from Iran. It comes as fears grow of a cluster outbreak in Sydney's northwest, where Australia's first school has been shut down because of a positive test result. The New South Wales Education Department is reportedly working to create digital classes, enabling students to log on from home as it prepares for the possibility of a mass shutdown. Cabin fever is setting in for passengers on board a quarantine ship off the coast of San Francisco. The 2,500 people on board, including four Australians, were due to have their test results in this morning, but the captain has confirmed they're delayed.
We will certainly let you know the results as soon as possible. We apologise for this delay, which is outside of our control.
A Coast Guard helicopter delivered the test kits to the cruise ship yesterday. Tasmania is considering culling our iconic kookaburra. The species is considered a pest by many locals, with the birds killing smaller native birds. Kookaburra numbers have blown out across the island state in recent years. The Duke of Sussex has arrived in style at an English racetrack alongside Formula One world champion driver Lewis Hamilton. He was driven to the Silverstone racetrack in Northamptonshire in an electric Mercedes to open a new museum showcasing the circuit's heritage. The racing complex costs nearly $30 million. The visit is one of Harry's final engagements as a senior royal before he steps down next month. And a huge congrats to Channel 7's own Bruce McAvaney, the legendary sports broadcaster, was honoured with a Melbourne Press Club Lifetime Achievement Award at the Equal Awards last night. Bruce has covered every Summer Olympics since Moscow in 1980 and remains our industry's gold standard for sports anchoring and commentating. Congrats to him.
Impeccable hair across the decades.
Yes,
the hair, not a bad day. I went through hundreds of hours of vision. I couldn't find one hair out of place.
He doesn't get it wrong, does he? Bruce, anything, ever.
And he will be at Flemington today, calling the Newmarket and the Australian Cup as well. And Seven's racing coverage live and free this network. Well done, Brucey. The Matildas are one game away from the Olympics after thrashing Vietnam in Newcastle last night. Captain Sam Kerr became the team's second highest international goal scorer, scoring twice in a 5-0 rout. The return leg in Vietnam on Wednesday. Mitchell Starc will fly home early from the Australian men's tour of South Africa so he can be at the MCG to cheer on wife Elisa Healy in tomorrow's Women's T20 World Cup final. The men play the final one day against SA tonight. Melbourne captain Jack Viney could be in a little bit of trouble after a dangerous sling tackle on Hawthorn skipper Ben Stratton in their pre-season win. Both teams have injury worries. Hawk Mitchell Lewis and Demon Sam Wiedemann hurting their ankles in the game. Geelong has kept its faint AFLW finals hopes alive after coming from behind at halftime to beat the Gold Coast Suns by 20 points. The Cats now sit fourth on the Conference A ladder.
The Waratahs have slipped to an embarrassing defeat after leading the Chiefs at half-time in Wollongong. The Tars conceded 38 unanswered points in a woeful second half to lose at 51-14. The Reds lost to the Crusaders 24-20, and the Brumbies were too strong for the Sunwolves, winning 47 points to 14. Australia will take a 2-0 lead into day two of the Davis Cup qualifier against Brazil. John Millman came from a set and a break down to win his match, while Jordan Thompson got the tie off to a winning start, beating Thiago Monteiro. Nice work with that. Demonor and Kyrgios as well. There's your sport.
Lovely.
Excellent sport it was. Thank you very much, Simon. Let's go to JT now, who's at Mammoth Mountain in California, doing a very good job of convincing us that he is at work.
This is work. A big thank you to Icon Pass. That's why we're here. And we started the morning easy. We've moved up to the pros. I've got a couple of pros, free skiers and free snowboarders. So Kimmy is a free skier, and Chris Benchetler is a free skier. Explain what a free skier does.
It kind of varies, but my role, since we're in Australia here, is the exact same as free surfing. I just kind of chase weather patterns. We both do, actually, but we chase weather patterns and film video parts, shoot photos, and just kind of, try and get the best content we can.
And Kimmy Vasani, Fire on the Mountain was shot here at Mammoth at nighttime in the backcountry.
Yeah, it was actually on the backside of Mammoth Mountain, and Mammoth is one of those places that offers everything, and we got so lucky here. Chris actually produced and directed that film on the backside of the Mammoth, and it was all lit up in beautiful colors at night during snowstorm.
I love this. You guys have got a little baby, 2-year-old, is that right? 2 years old. You've got a skier and a snowboarder in the family. Who decides if he's a skier or a snowboarder?
He kind of gets to choose himself. He likes doing both, so we try to take him out and introduce him to this wonderful playground.
All right, well, we're going to wrap up today by doing a little skiing and snowboarding here at Mammoth. And tomorrow, we're going to be at Squaw, another resort on the Icon Pass here in California. But let's have a look at your weather forecast first.
This is Weekend Sunrise Weather.
Brisbane, showers in 29. Sydney, showers in 24. In Canberra, a possible shower today and a top of 22. Melbourne, partly cloudy in 21. Some light showers in Hobart and 16. Adelaide, mostly sunny and 25 degrees. Humid in Perth today, 27. Sunny in Broome and 35. In Darwin, possible storms in 33. And sunny and 30 degrees in Alice Springs. All right, I'll bring my pieces of paper with me and we are going to hit it. Let's go. We'll see you tomorrow at Squaw. Goggles down. Why am I doing this in front of professional skis and snowboarders? Take it away, guys.
Go, JT.
You look the part, JT.
I can't stand people that can do things.
Just a quick little step.
They had that other vision of me, though, doing the snowboarding that we saw.
Well done, Duncan.
He's doing it backwards.
So really,
awesome.
The most impressive part of
this. That's amazing.
He deserves all the praise.
Isn't he really skiing down backwards?
Yes.
Doing? No,
yes.
Look, because it's some kind of toboggan or something, because you can see the tracks. Am I the only smart person on this dance?
Clearly.
Probably. Don't spoil the illusion.
You're always telling us that.
Yeah, exactly.
The bigger issue here is that Sally has been lusting after a stack with JT.
JT hasn't.
He's too good.
He looks very good.
Smooth.
All right.
No, those people are so mighty cool,
fine.
Aren't they?
Looks wonderful.
He could have at least snowplowed to make the rest of us feel better about ourselves.
It's a bit aggravating. All right, well, stay with us here on Weekend Sunrise. Watch this spice. See what I did there. The girls are preparing for another reunion. Mel C's Big Hint Australia is in their plans.
Please.
Please.
Plus, we're delighted about this. Ben Elton is joining us live, the comedy genius behind Blackadder, The Young Ones, and so many more classics. He is here at Brekkie Central. That's next. Welcome back. Well, our next guest is quite simply comedy royalty. He's made us laugh out loud for almost 40 years. He's entertained millions with his television programs, movies, theatre shows, stand-ups, he acts, he's written 16 novels, it goes on and on and on.
He is British but had the very good sense to marry an Australian and raise his family. Here he is, Ben Elton, and he's back touring Australia for his first stand-up shows in 15 years. Ben, good morning. Welcome to Weekend Sunrise.
Lovely to be back.
An absolute treat to have you on today.
Yeah, it really
so
is.
You're dipping back into stand-up. It's been a little while. Someone of your calibre wouldn't get nervous still, do you? You're going to be rusty?
Well, not now, because I'm midway through it. I'm not so much dipping as I've dived fully and immersed myself. I've just done 75 dates in the UK.
Wow.
Obviously all butter preparation for the Australian tour, just to sort of really warm-ups, just so I get it right for here in New Zealand. So it's got a lot. I feel good about it. I don't know about nervous last Northern summer, July, August, when I was writing it, but putting together a whole new two-hour show, first time in so many years. Yeah, there was a lot of. I recognise that anybody who would still want to come and see me would have a lifetime's experience of what I do and expectations. So yeah, there was nerves, but it feels good because it's gone very well.
I don't want to be
complacent, but you know, maybe the Aussies will be tougher. But yeah, the Poms seem to enjoy it.
Well, we just talked about you as being comedy royalty, and you really are. And like some of them, the young ones, Blackadder, you've worked with all of the best.
You're not going to make me drop the royal like poor Meghan and Harry.
And Harry.
No, you can keep that.
I'll just be comedy. I've had to drop the royal. Well,
it doesn't have the same ring though, does it? Just comedy.
He's comedy.
He's comedy.
Yeah,
that's it.
Feels good.
Have things changed, do you think? You know, now that we've got trolls and people say you've got to be so much more careful about what you say. I mean, I know that you're not more careful, but do you think it puts other comedians off?
Well, I've always been careful. I don't like to give offence, and much more importantly, I don't like to be misunderstood.
Mm.
This idea that I actually deal with it quite a lot in the new show. You know, people say to me, "You're going on tour. Oh, you're brave." I say, "Why?" I say, "Well, you can't say anything anymore, can you? You know, what are you going to say? It seems like the only thing you can say is that you can't say anything." I don't agree with that at all. I think that on the whole, generally, this idea that there's some trollish world of people shutting down debate, that the new woke generation are denying comedy and shutting up common sense, you know, and poor middle-aged white men are losing their connection. Well, that's obviously not worked against Trump, Morrison or Boris Johnson, you know. I actually think it's actually a right-wing myth, this idea that new ideas somehow shut down old ideas. I'm kind of pro-PC on the whole, and mostly what I consider PC is just political correctness, it's just good manners, just recognising that we live in a much more multi-cultural, ethnic, it's not a binary culture, it's not a monoculture, and it's recognising that we're not all the same. I do a little riff in the routine about how everything that we now consider bog-standard human rights were once considered PC gone mad.
Yeah.
You know, what's that, Mrs. Pankhurst? Women having the vote? Sounds going a bit far, isn't it? Sounds like PC gone mad to me. I mean, every change, you know, takes a little bit of getting used to. But I think if comedians want to, there's no subjects that are out of bounds, but on the whole, I have the same rules I've always had. Don't punch down. Don't attack a minority just to get a cheap laugh from the majority.
Mm.
And that's, I think, really all that's being talked about. I mean, sure, when you get, you know, silly over, you know, when people are a single tweet, suddenly somebody's got to shut up. Yes, we have to be a little bit careful about freedom of speech. But on the whole, I don't think reactionary voices are being silenced very quickly, frankly.
It's amazing to hear. You work with some of the biggest names, of course, in the world, but your passion for comedy, it's still very much alive listening
Absolutely.
To you talk now. How was the writing process for you? Was it difficult? Was it invigorating?
Well, it always starts with a blank page. My stand-up tour is no different from a play or a sitcom. I sit down alone in my study. I write and I write. I show stuff to my wife, to Sophie. We talk about it. Although with stand-up, probably that's the least, I don't show it so much because nothing goes down worse than saying, "Oh, do you think this will be funny?" Because you sell it so badly. But the passion is the same as always, the idea to communicate ideas through the comic arts. And I think that stand-up is a great medium for ideas. I mean, you know, straight gag-telling is great. You know, Jimmy Carr, for instance, wonderful. Series of non-sequiturs.
Yeah.
It's wonderful. I love it. But that's not what I do. For me, it's about expressing how I'm feeling, what's on my mind, how do I feel about myself, about the world, the community I live in. So it is invigorating. I'm led by my own passions, by the things that excite me, obviously the things that outrage me, and that's what I feed into the kind of comedy pot and try and produce an overall routine.
It's a fascinating thing that you do, and in fact there aren't others that are doing it where you talk about ideas and make it so funny in the same way. Brilliant stuff. We'll put all the details about your tour online, and we don't often do this. We don't give gifts to our guests.
But comedy royalty deserves it, though, Ben.
Am I expected to knight you?
Have you done much shopping lately in Australia? It's tough out there in the
storm.
This madness. I'm going to give these away. We have to work as a community, and isn't it? I mean, I worry if what's happening at the moment leads to a toilet roll shortage. What are we going to do if there's a real crisis? Having said that, I'll be checking them in.
You could auction them off for a decent price.
Hand luggage to
paper
Perth.
Apocalypse. We could only get you the black and gold. That's literally all we could buy.
It's not recycled. I'm not sure if it. Well, hopefully it is. I'll look
somewhere. Only one that we could buy, but we think that it's soft enough.
Well, I shall be checking it in at the airport to WA today. No, I. Well,
just
anyway,
so you know, no one else has been given that.
I thought you were going to say no one else has used any of it. Goodness gracious.
There's one in the middle that I'd avoid. Thank you, Ben.
Pleasure
so
chatting
much.
With you, Ben.
So
thank you.
Lovely to see you.
Now, Ben Elton's tour starts in Perth on April the 20th. There are the dates right there. Getting quick. They are selling fast. We'll put all the details on our website. How good. Coming up this morning, how to greet people in these uncertain times. The hilarious suggestions on avoiding shaking hands, but still seeming friendly. That's odd. All right, that's coming up on Weekend Sunrise. Hello, hello. Well, it's that time again. Time for pop news with Sal.
Good morning. Well, rumours continue to swirl that the Spice Girls are planning to reunite with Victoria Beckham for the 50th anniversary of the Glastonbury Music Festival in June. Mel C, who's currently visiting Brizzy at the moment, has hinted it's on the cards. And if the girls do reunite, they owe it to Australian fans to tour here. Now, Sporty Spice, of course, got together with Scary Spice, Ginger Spice and Baby Spice last year for a tour of Ireland in the UK. But despite their best efforts, they couldn't get Posh on board. Of course, the girls do like to keep fans guessing, so I guess it's a case of watch this space. Talk show host Stephen Colbert has come up with some inventive ways to shake hands amid the coronavirus crisis. We're not sure if any of these greetings will actually catch on, but they are creative. So good.
It's awesome.
And just finally, multi-platinum and global award-winning superstar Christina Aguilera has released a new original song for the live-action remake of Mulan. The song is called Loyal, Brave, True and will be featured in the film, which will premiere in Australia on March 26th. Here it is. Underneath my armor, am I loyal, brave and true? Am I loyal, go. Should be a big premiere, that one, guys.
What a voice. All right, Sal, thank you.
Thank you, Sal. Well, stay with us. We have breaking news coming in on that quarantine cruise ship in San Francisco. Those details coming up.
On Weekend Sunrise, wiping out the mortgage. How so many homeowners are now able to do it. Debt and worry-free. That's from 7 a.m.
We have some breaking news now on that cruise ship off San Francisco. 21 out of the 46 passengers on the Grand Princess have just tested positive for coronavirus. The public health response is still being determined.
Now, we saw helicopters drop off test kits yesterday. There are more than 3,500 passengers on board. We understand that there are 4 Australians. We don't know whether any of those Australians were among the 21 who have confirmed with coronavirus. All guests remain in their rooms until further notice. Imagine that. Just imagine the cabin fever.
That is going to be a lot of backgammon and I spy with my little eye.
Very stressful too for all those on board. I mean, given what's happened.
Not knowing when you're going to get off.
The other issue is access to medicines and medications for a lot of people on board who are elderly and who need them. But that's just a microcosm of what's going on around the world now. So many people in limbo.
Lots of people thinking about it. But we hope we can put that aside and just have an enjoyable day today. It's been lovely to have your company. We'll have more details during the day on 7news.com.au and tonight, 7 News at 6. See you tomorrow, everyone.
Bye-bye.